Directory of the Fourth Book. The purpose of the fourth book is to teach the soul how to unite herself with God her Savior. This is effected by divine love. Now, this whole book treats of the divine love, its causes, its effects, its various ways. These are things, if looked into at their very source, if considered in the very heart of Jesus, loving, that we may return his love, burning that we may melt, uniting himself with us that we may unite ourselves with him, must needs ravish our hearts, melt us wholly, so as to become, in some manner, one with him. This life of divine union, which is the most perfect and the most blissful portion of the interior life, is not to be so understood as if the souls that live this life ought no longer to perform any exercise pertaining to the purificative or the illuminative life. The practices of these three sorts of lives are never, on this earth, altogether separated. So long as you live, to whatever degree of the divine union you may have attained, you shall always have something to do, in order to cleanse the heart more perfectly, or to preserve it pure. You shall always have to practice virtue, either by doing or by suffering. But this life is to be so understood, that the soul, when duly cleansed, and sufficiently adorned with genuine and solid virtues, acquired by generous act of self-abnegation, lives in intimacy with Jesus her God, enjoying a certain holy, mutual, and unspeakable familiarity with him, relishes what he relishes, wills what he wills, dislikes what he dislikes, occupies herself, meanwhile, for the most part, with those exercises, those acts, by which this union is fostered and consolidated, although, sometimes, through love, rather than any other motive, she performs such things as belong to the purifying of the interior, or the practicing of virtues. In like manner, souls, that labor for the most part to purify themselves interiorly, or apply themselves, for the most part, to acquire solidly true virtues, are said to lead the life of purification or of illumination, according as they occupy themselves commonly with the one or the other, even if they perform, at the same time, many practices, which properly belong to other parts of the interior life. And these things are to be carefully attended to, lest a person fall into a delusion, here particularly full of danger. Therefore, unless he is willing to be deceived, and to imperil himself, let no mortal ever think that he has not to labor any further, that he has no longer anything to accomplish. Above all, let no one ever believe that he has no longer anything to fear, that he may freely expose himself to danger, under this or the like pretense, that he is not moved by any created object, or that he seeks or wills nothing except God. By such a delusion they themselves, who were distinguished by the name of sanctity, and the glory of martyrdom, and glittered like stars in the firmament, have shamefully fallen into the abyss. From this same source of presumption other delusions flow, such as, to neglect one's duties, or other signs of God's will, for the sake of quietly reposing amid the delights of divine favor, to seek rather the gifts of the Lord than the Lord himself, to desire things which are extraordinary. When, therefore, you are in this part, you ought to direct everything to this, that you evermore love Jesus, your God and Savior, and that you, by the purest love, unite yourself intimately with him. Now, this love is obtained by considering his countless favors, the ineffable workings of the love of his heart, his stupendous and most delightful promises, lastly, all the good things which he prepares for you in time. And in eternity, by contemplating his most lovely and infinite perfections, on account of which alone he is most worthy of all possible love, finally, by prayer, by visits in person or in spirit to the most blessed sacrament, by dealing devotedly and fervently with him in holy communion. The method of using this book may be one of the four laid down before the first and second books. Of these, each one may here follow that method which he believes more useful for himself, according to the state of his soul, and which he will so apply to the matter here proposed, as to secure the object of this book. However, it should be carefully noticed, as in others, so especially in this part of the interior life, that it is by no means proper to adhere to a settled manner or method, that you do not suffer yourself to be guided by heavenly grace, or by the Spirit of God, who is accustomed frequently, particularly with regard to souls that, purified and illumined, take pains to unite themselves wholly with God, to pass by every mode or method, to leave off almost all processes of reasoning, to enrapture the heart, to raise it up into His admirable light, and to affect it in an unutterable manner. The affections, to which it is proper to give yourself up, and the acts which you ought to excite, are chiefly these, of gratitude, or of thanksgiving for the gifts and graces granted to yourself and to others, also, for the glory, the beatitude, and the perfection of the Lord our God, as the Church teaches us by her example, when she says, "We thank thee for thy own great glory." Of joy, on account of His mercy, His liberality, His love toward yourself, and all other creatures, on account of His perfections in themselves, on account of His honor, and blissfulness, and joy. Of confidence in the goodness of His heart, in His care, in His providence. Of admiration, on account of the magnitude and the multitude of the blessings bestowed upon yourself and others, the works of divine love, His infinite perfections. Of praise, so as to extol His marvelous works, now alone by yourself, now in union with the Church, again by inviting all creatures, and again by associating yourself with the saints and angels in heaven. Of zeal, for His honor and glory, and for the salvation and perfection of souls, for His sake. Of humility, so as to remember and acknowledge that you are worthless, but that God is generous, since He pours out for you the treasures of His heart. Of filial love, whereby you are filled with a holy dread of offending the Lord, whereby you lovingly grieve for the offences with which His heart has been saddened by yourself and others. Of pure love, whereby you give, surrender, and sacrifice yourself and all you possess, to Him, whereby you conform yourself in all things to His will and good pleasure, whereby, finally, you live uniform, completely united with Him. But these and other acts, as elsewhere, so especially are they here to be made in such a manner, that, so long as you can usefully occupy yourself with one, you do by no means pass over to another, but continue to entertain yourself sweetly and devoutly with the same, until either the time of prayer is past, or the Spirit of grace leads you to others. But if, whilst you endeavor affectionately and quietly to adhere to one act or affection, you find that you can no longer apply yourself to it, pass over to some other, suggested either by the wants of your soul, your own devotion, or the Spirit of grace. Lastly, suffer yourself freely to be led by the Spirit of the Lord to whatever is good, whether to meditation, or to contemplation, to deal with Him by means of the affections, or to repose in His presence, to hold converse with Him, or to hearken to Him, to ask or to give. Neither use any efforts to remain actually conscious of your occupations in prayer. The rules, which do properly belong here, for the discernment of spirits, inasmuch as they are quite nice and delicate, must be well learned and understood, so that they may be applied with profit. The saints teach us the following. The first. There is a twofold divine union, with a consummation of the same. The first is called active, the second, passive union. The active union consists in the perfect uniformity of our will with the divine will. This is the whole perfection of divine love. Through this union the sentiments of the heart of Jesus are our sentiments, the Spirit of Jesus is our spirit, the life of Jesus our life. Hence, sweetly united with Jesus, we enjoy Him constantly, and we are truly made blissful. The passive union, on the other hand, consists in this, that, by the abundance of light and love poured in, the faculties are suspended, so that the memory does not remember, the intellect does not think, the will does not love, except the Lord God, the whole soul being so absorbed by the divine object, that she does not perceive this state of suspension. This union, replenished with marvelous and most delightful gifts, is, generally, each time of short duration, nor is it wont to last an hour. Hence, during the intervals, the soul should be occupied and content with the active union. Everyone may attain to the active union by faithfulness to the grace which is given him, but no human industry, the divine goodness alone can raise the soul to the passive union. The consummation of the divine union consists in this, that the soul united with the Lord, is, in some manner, so transformed into the divine object of her love, that, the faculties being neither suspended nor impeded, she herself, habitually, placidly, and sweetly enjoys her Lord, being wholly, in a wonderful and delightful manner, absorbed as it were, in Him, and, nevertheless, exceedingly well disposed both to action and to contemplation. The second. It is a safer way to long and seek after the active union, rather than the passive, or the things which are sometimes vouchsafed in the passive, such as visions, revelations, and similar communications. It may happen that souls that live in the active union have much more merit than those to whom the passive union is granted, because they do and endure greater and more generous things for the Lord, and they are satisfied, according to the divine good pleasure, to be deprived of those consolations given to others, but not to themselves, in the present life, which they will receive when more sweetly and more abundantly bestowed in the life to come. The third. Let the soul, in order to move and incite herself to do and bear great and noble things for the Lord, acknowledge and confess that she has received and does receive many and great things from the Lord, not that she may deem herself better than others, but that she may serve Him with more generosity and perfection. Therefore, let her reject, as coming not from the good but from the evil spirit, every thought, every emotion, which, under any pretense whatsoever, leads her to complaints about her misery, to dejection of heart, or pusillanimousness. The fourth. Whatever outpourings of the divine goodness the soul may receive, howsoever intimately she may be united with God, however much she may even be made perfect in the supreme good, she ought always to remember that she is not impeccable, but that she may still perish, unless she be faithful to the Lord. And, therefore, the more and the greater favors she receives, the more humble it benefits her to be, and the more purely should she love God. Hence, if she be moved to rely upon the long duration of her virtuous life, or the firmness of her good resolves, or the solidity of her virtue, in order to expose herself to dangers, let her know that she is moved by the evil, not the good spirit. The fifth. Matters which lead or call you away from the Catholic faith, such as some instigations and communications, should be carefully and powerfully rejected, as the effects of the evil spirit. Those, on the contrary, which are consistent with the Catholic faith, and serve to unite the soul with her Lord and God, may be received with humble thankfulness, as fruits of the good spirit, and they may even be asked humbly and resignedly, with the intention that the soul may increase in the love of God, and become more perfectly united with Him. The sixth. When it is known that, by means of the communications received, the soul becomes more and more dead to herself, is animated with desire of greater perfection, and advances in the love of God, it is a sign that they come from the good spirit. But when it is perceived that, in consequence of these communications, the soul becomes inclined to gratify corrupt nature, or loses the hunger and thirst after greater perfection, or that with a sort of stubbornness she wants to defend or hold the communications as divine, although the director of her conscience does not believe so, or is in doubt about it, it is a sign that they come from the evil spirit. The seventh. The soul should not desire visions or revelations, nor place her perfection and sanctity in having them. Let her remember that, through them, several have been deceived and have fallen into the greatest danger. If she experiences a longing after them, let her believe, without a doubt, that it has been suggested or excited by the evil spirit, and let her check and expel the same. The eighth. The more eagerly extraordinary things of this kind are coveted, the greater danger they present, that the soul may be deluded, and led away from the true path of sanctity, which Jesus the meek and humble of heart has indicated, and which the saints follow.
I was dead, my child, and now I am living forevermore. I had come forth from the Father, and had come into the world, at last I was leaving the world to return to the Father. However, the love of my heart did not allow nor suffer that I should leave them orphans, whom I cherished more than my own life. The love of my Father called and invited me, that, coming, I might be glorified with Him, with the glory which I had with Him before the world was created. The love of men also invited and urged me on, that, staying among them, I might comfort them amid all the troubles of life. and my heart invented a means of satisfying both my love for my Father, and my love for men. A mystery, my child, that going up into heaven I may be seated at the right of the Father, and abide with you even to the consummation of the world. A mystery, which, unless I myself had drawn it forth from my heart, no mortal could ever have imagined, a mystery which transcends all created nature, a mystery, in fine, which exceeds all finite power. There is need, therefore, of stupendous miracles, to be wrought by divine omnipotence alone. But love triumphs, love, which in my divine heart found the design, there also found the power of executing the same. All things are possible, all things are easy, if I will them in my heart, whose will is power and execution. As men were not able to bear the sight of my glorified majesty, and the world could not subsist in the effulgence of such a brightness, regard was to be had to their weakness, lest, alarmed at the splendor of my greatness, they might be kept away. Therefore, I must conceal my dazzling glory, and display nothing that might fill them with dread. Moreover, my child, since you have here no permanent city, but look for one to come, it is expedient for you that I abide with you under another form, lest, forgetting that you are a pilgrim on earth, you be willing to make here your abode, and cling to the things of the present, but that, mindful of your place of exile, you may aspire to your country, where you shall be able, with face unveiled, to gaze upon my glory. Lastly, since this life is short, and after it there shall be no longer any time to gain merits, it is good and most useful that I hide my countenance, that you may have a greater opportunity of reducing to practice faith, as well as all other virtues. If for so many reasons it is advantageous that I dwell in another form among men upon earth, from among all possible forms that one should be chosen, which is best suited to my heart, and most profitable to men. Now, my child, since I came down to men, that they might have spiritual life, and since I stay in their midst that they may have it more abundantly, and as the spiritual life bears in every way a resemblance to the material life, which is sustained and strengthened by natural food, they need a supernatural food, whereby the life of the spirit may be preserved, may grow in solidity, and flourish more and more. It is better, therefore, that I remain under the appearance of food, since I am not only the bread of life, but life itself. For how much more abundantly will the faithful soul have life, if she be nourished with life itself? Besides, child, my heart is love, but love is the gift of oneself, and does not rest until it has given and united itself to the object beloved. Now, as in the life of nature, nothing is more intimately united than food and the one that takes it, so also in the spiritual life, by the gift of my love, the greatest and most intimate union occurs between the soul and myself. This is that divine and beatific union, whereby one can render every soul blissful, the work of a boundless love. Finally, I am pleased to stay among men under the form of a banquet, which is a token of the greatest friendship, in order that, even upon earth, the faithful may rejoice in my supernatural fellowship, which the blessed in heaven enjoy, and that they may recall with delight that never-ending bliss, where I dispose to you a kingdom, that you may eat and drink at my table, and where, girding myself and going about, I will minister to you. This will be the union everlasting, and thrillingly blissful, the Passover of never-ending joy, the wine of eternal love, which I will drink with you ever new in the kingdom of my Father. In order that men might gradually be prepared for mysteries so great, I willed that, in many ways, all this should be foreshadowed in the old law. A figure, was the fruit of the tree of life planted in paradise, by the food of which men, in a state of innocence, were to be nourished, and to bloom with life, that they might preserve themselves from death, and thus secure immortality. A figure which was the bread and wine offered by Melchizedek, the priest and king, priest of the Most High, King of Salem, King of Peace. A figure which was the Paschal Lamb, the Lamb without blemish, which was both offered and eaten, which was to be consumed neither raw nor cooked, but prepared with fire, and they that eat it were to have their loins girded, shoes on their feet, staves in their hands, as if in readiness to go on a journey. A figure which was the manna in the desert, which fell every day from heaven, possessed the pleasantness of every kind of savor, was called the bread of angels, of which neither he that gathered more than the usual measure had more, nor he that collected less than another possessed less. A figure which was the Ark of the Covenant, wherein the majesty of God was honored between the cherubim, and where he was wont, day and night, to impart to his people propitiation, aid, and comfort. Lastly, a figure which was the bread baked under the ashes, whereby the prophet was freed from his faintness and depression of spirit, and, endowed with new vigor, walked, on the strength of that food, even to the mountain of God. It was known to me, my child, how much this institution would cost me, how great and how many a sacrifice this my sacramental life would require. I know to what humiliations I subject myself, to how many insults I expose myself. But all these my heart deems less than the love, whereby it is borne towards my Father and towards men. My love is overcome by no obstacles, it triumphs easily over all. More, these very difficulties themselves, it looks upon and displays, as so many proofs of its greatness and generosity. See, then, eminently the great sacrament of affectionateness, which, conceived by my love before all ages, was realized by my supreme power in time, appeared wonderful to the angels, was preached to the nations, which has consoled the world, and which by its sweetness has inebriated the hearts of mortals.
O the height, the wisdom and love of heart, Jesus, Son of the living God! How marvelous, how stupendous are its works! How lovely, O Lord, how sweet! Behold, how you love us, most loving Jesus! You annihilated yourself for love of us, taking upon you the form of food, becoming like nourishment, and being found under the appearance of bread, but the bread of life everlasting. Oh, what power of love did enkindle your heart, when about to pass from this world to the Father! You instituted this most wonderful, this most delightful means of abiding with us, and of abiding in such a manner. O prodigy of love! O divine institution! Wherein you yourself, O most benign Jesus, are at once the banquet and the guest, the offering and the offerer, the joy of angels and of men. Thanks to you, Lord Jesus, eternal thanks to you for the unutterable goodness of your heart, whereby you bestowed upon us this incomparable blessing. Would that I were able to return you suitable thanks for so great a gift. Come, angels and saints of God, come, all peoples and tribes, give thanks with me, to the Lord, let us praise, and exceedingly magnify him, for this the love of his heart. Let us sing a new canticle to the Lord, for that, abiding with us after a new manner, he pours forth upon us from him, heart, blessings ever new. Let us joyfully sing to God, our Saviour, let us fall down before him, let us weep for joy and gratitude in his presence. O Jesus, infinite love, who through love came into this world, and remain here through love you become wholly mine. To you, in return, I give and deliver my heart, all my affections, my whole self, grant, I beseech you, that, by love, I may be yours for evermore, that whatever I am and possess, may be at the disposal of your love and glory. Take away from me all obstacles to your love, extinguish in me every ill-ordered affection, that nothing may affect, nothing may move me, except what concerns yourself, or your interests. You, O delight of my heart, you, O bliss of my soul! Do you live and reign in me, be you from now the first and last object of my thoughts and affections, let me be always occupied with you, or for you, who are all to me.
I am the living bread, that came down from heaven. He that comes to me shall not hunger, for the bread which I shall give him is my flesh for the life of the world. When I had said these things, my child, the Jews disputed among themselves, saying, How can this man give us his flesh to eat? And, in reply to them, I declared positively, Verily, verily, I say to you, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man, and drink his blood, you shall not have life in you. For my flesh is meat indeed, and my blood is drink indeed. Before the festival day of the Passover, knowing that my hour had come, that I should pass out of this world to the Father, having loved my own who were in the world, I loved them unto the end. It being now evening, I sat down to the Last Supper, and the 12 disciples with me, to them, as they were seated around, I said, With desire, I have desired to eat this Passover with you. And while they were at supper, I took bread, and blessed, and broke, and gave it to my disciples, saying, Take and eat, this is my body. And taking the chalice, I gave thanks, and gave to them, saying, Drink all of this, this is my blood. Do this for a commemoration of me.
These, then, are your words, Lord God, truth eternal, whereby you did solemnly promise beforehand, that you would give yourself to us as the bread of life. These are the deeds whereby you did afterwards truly fulfill what you had promised. Your church, taught by these words and deeds, even before they had been recorded, enjoyed this, your divine gift, and was doing this, as you had enjoined, for a commemoration of you. By these words, you did overthrow and thwart the foreseen difficulties of infidels, and the objections of heretics, and the temptations of demons. For, by them, you taught, that whatever you, the infallible truth, uttered must be believed, even if we do not understand how these things can be. And through the Holy Church, your true spouse, we know the things you uttered, but in what manner the mysteries which you proclaimed by words, were inwardly constituted, or realized, that we do not comprehend, since our limited reason cannot reach those things which transcend all the bounds of reason. If we do not understand the things which are below ourselves, how shall we understand those which are above us? That a seed sown in the ground, after it has decayed, grows up into a new stalk, and produces much fruit, we believe, because we perceive it outwardly. But how these things happen intrinsically, although they belong to the natural order, we are unable to penetrate. Should he not deservedly be regarded as unsound in mind, who, while, by means of the senses, he perceives that there are mysteries of nature, would not be willing to admit them, because he does not comprehend how they do exist. Now, even by means of the senses, we perceive that there are mysteries of religion revealed by you, because faith comes by hearing, and, moreover, by reason itself, we see that those mysteries are true, because it is evident to reason, that it is impossible that you, the essential truth, should utter what is false. The submission, therefore, of all them that faithfully believe in you, is reasonable. But they that refuse to believe you thinking themselves wise, have become fools, and altogether unreasonable. And it proceeds from a secret pride, instigated by the cunning of the devil, that they are unwilling to subject to you its author, the noblest gift, their reason, and to honor you, by the submission of the same. But all they that at any time have been humble children of the church, however greatly they were distinguished for their genius, have brought their intellect under subjection, to obey you by faith. By this you show that thou art the Lord of all, good towards all, no respecter of persons, and that from all, from the learned, as well as from the unlearned, you desire the obedience of a subdued intellect and a submissive will. Lord God, my Creator and Redeemer, I prostrate myself before you, and submit my reason wholly to you, by my whole intellect and will, my body, and all my senses, in obedience to faith, for you glory. But it is also my glory and advantage that I may return to you, their beginning and end, all the gifts of soul and body which I have received from you, and that, by means of whatever I have received, in the order of nature, I may freely cooperate with your grace for the supernatural order, and, consequently, for my own everlasting honor, my never-ending bliss. Reason and faith are both your gifts, Lord, the former a natural, the latter a supernatural gift, both ever assist each other, and never contrary, both given for truth, each one in its own order. If I believe, because my natural reason moves me to, my faith is a natural one, neither supernatural nor saving. If I believe, because a supernatural motive impels me, my faith is supernatural and salutary. Blessed are they who have not seen and have believed. And, certainly, how can the senses perceive what does not fall under the senses? Or, how can reason comprehend what does not lie within the grasp of reason? Or, how can the cold utterance of man explain that which the exceeding love of thy heart has effected? Therefore, in the spirit of your church, I firmly believe that you, O Lord Jesus Christ, true God and man, are truly and substantially contained in the most blessed sacrament, under the appearance of things visible, bread and wine. I do firmly believe that you are wholly and entirely present under each species, and under every part of each species, if they be separated. I do firmly believe that you, the present in your glorified state, are the same, whom, at your entrance into the world, the angels adored, whom Mary and Joseph, the shepherds and the magi, worshipped under the form of a child, who, meek and humble of heart, did go about doing good, who, having died for us, did rise again, who, having gone up to heaven, are seated in glory at the right of God the Father. I do not, as the Jews, ask for signs, nor search into the manner. I do not desire, like the unbelievers, to understand reasons intrinsically concealed. I do not require, like heretics, that my individual judgment be gratified. For me the testimony of your infallible spouse, the Holy Church, which is the ground of the truth, is sufficient. I reject whatsoever is opposed to her doctrine. This is my security, my faith. O Lord God of infinite majesty, you the saint of the saints, who are so marvelously and so lovingly hidden in this mystery. You, I adore, you I worship devotedly. Humbly prostrate, with body and soul, in your presence, I profess before heaven and earth that you are my God and my Savior. To you do I pay the supreme worship, due to your majesty. I offer to you also the adorations, honors, and homage which the angels, and the saints, and your whole church pay to you. Oh, that all men would acknowledge you, would adore you, would show you homage and reverence. But, since so many fail in their duty, I, O Lord, uniting myself with your saints and angels, and all faithful souls, do adore and venerate you in their stead, and I desire, in this manner, to make amends for the negligence of all unfaithful souls. O Jesus! Whatever I may be able to do for you, is as nothing in comparison of what I owe to you. In this most delightful sacrament, by the pure love of your heart, you have given me whatever you possess, your body and soul, your humanity and divinity, with all their treasures. I owe, therefore, to you, as much as you are worth, you who are infinite. I give to you, in return, my body and soul, whatever I have, whatever I am, but behold, after I have given all this, my debt remains infinite. It is good for me, Lord Jesus, that I am thus indebted to you, that I may be moved and impelled to love without bounds the infinite goodness of your heart. Mindful of your pure and boundless love, O Jesus, I love you, in return, with my whole heart, and I long to be able to satisfy you by an unlimited love. Help me, O most loving Jesus, that I may love you with that affection, that tenderness, that reverence, which love alone can inspire. Grant that, from now, I may live by pure love for you, who by infinite love live for me in the most holy tabernacle. By your most sacred heart, thus made a captive, thus detained by love, I beg and implore you, to bind my heart to your heart, that it may be a captive of your love, and be never detached nor separated from it.
My child, the Church exults at this most excellent favor of my heart, and venerates this supreme miracle of my love with every demonstration of devotedness. Enraptured at the excess of the goodness of my heart, she melts with love for me, she rejoices securely in the possession of my most delightful presence, and continues to rejoice, while generations pass by, while the face of the earth is changed, and ages speed away. See how, in every age of the past, from the east and the west, from the north and the south, the children of the Church have arisen and have called their mother blessed, on account of so great a love of my heart, which abides with her all days even to the consummation of the world. In this presence, uninterrupted, and full of mutual love, I celebrate the Great Supper, the divine festival of my spiritual nuptials, with my Immaculate Spouse, the Holy Church. To these the faithful are invited and called, be they poor, and weak, and blind, and lame, that the house may be filled with guests, and that their joy may be full.
Hear this, O mortals, and come clothed with the nuptial garment. Hear, taste and see how sweet is the Lord. To this sacred banquet, at which the angels minister, all the truly faithful do, always and everywhere, come adorned with this festive garment, that, being pleasing to the Lord, they may, whilst they are nourished and refreshed, rejoice with him. But they that are without this garment, being defiled, do rightly abstain, because they deservedly fear, lest they eat and drink judgment to themselves, or because they do not confess that the Eucharist is the body of our Savior, Jesus Christ, which suffered for our sins, and which the Father raised to life. 1 Corinthians. And, Saint Ignatius. Saint Justin quote, but we have been taught that the Eucharist is the body and blood of Jesus Christ, who became incarnate. Quote from Saint Ignatius, how great a gift is, therefore, bestowed not only upon our soul, but also upon our body, which is nourished with the body and blood of the Lord. Quote from Origen, hence, how great a reverence is required. Ye know, ye who are accustomed to assist at the divine mysteries, how, when ye receive the body of the Lord, ye watch with all care and reverence, that nothing, be it ever so little, fall down, that nought of the consecrated gift slip off, for ye believe yourselves guilty, if, through carelessness, anything do fall. So great is the precaution ye use, and deservedly so. No sooner had the Church emerged from the persecution of 300 years, than, rejoicing and crowned with laurels, she, in her first general council, her sons having been assembled from every part of the world, regulated the manner in which the divine sacrament should be dispensed throughout the world, in order that so sacred a mystery might everywhere be handled with holy awe. She does not bring forward new things, but, faithful guardian of her deposit, she recalls and inculcates the ancient practices. Neither the rule, says this watchful mother, nor custom has handed it down, that they, who have not the power of offering the sacrifice, should present the body of Christ to them that offer the same. Let them receive according to their rank the Holy Communion from the bishop or the priest, after the clergy. The First Council of Nicaea. Behold the Most Holy Communion. Behold the sacrament of the Lord. For under the appearance of bread, he gives us his body, under the appearance of wine he gives us his blood, that, when you have received the same, you taste the body and blood of Christ, having become partakers of his body and blood, for thus we become Christiferi, that is, bearing Christ in our bodies, thus, according to the blessed Peter, we are made partakers of the divine nature. Saint Cyril of Jerus. Bread, indeed, it is before the sacramental words, but when the consecration has been pronounced thereon, of bread it becomes the body of Christ. By which words then, and by whose language is the consecration made? By the words of Christ the Lord. Therefore, the word of Christ affects this sacrament. Which word of Christ? The one, whereby all things were made. The Lord commanded, and the heavens were made. The Lord commanded, and the earth was made. The Lord commanded, and every creature was produced. You see, then, how effective is the word of Christ. If, then, there is so great a power in the word of the Lord Jesus, that things, which were not, began to exist, how much the more effective is it to change into another that which did already exist. He spoke, and it was done. Saint Ambrose. O sacrament of godliness. O sign of unity. O bond of charity. He that desires to live has where he may live, whereby he may live. Let him become incorporate that he may receive life. Let him not be a decayed member, which deserves to be cut off, let him not be a misshapen one, of which he is ashamed. Let him be fair, fit, sound, let him cleave to the body, let him live of God for God. Saint Augustine. As many of us, therefore, as become partakers of this body, let us reflect that we taste him, who is seated above, who is adored by the angels. That which the angels dare not freely gaze upon, by reason of the dazzling splendor, by that we are here nourished, to that we are united, with that we became one body. In order, therefore, that we may not only become this by charity, let us also in very deed be blended with that body, for this is effected by the food which he has granted to us. Let us, then, go away from that table, like lions breathing fire, having become an object of dread to the devil. Saint Chrysostom. How goodly is that bread which nourishes the angels by its outward appearance, that they may be sated there within the land of bliss, and us by faith, that we may not faint on the way. That man might eat the bread of angels, the Creator of angels became man, nourishing both, and remaining whole and entire. Saint Fulgentius. They, however, that live wickedly, and do not cease to communicate, thinking that, by such a communion, they are cleansed, let them learn that they make no progress toward the cleansing, but toward condemnation. For the body of Christ is the food of saints. Saint Isidore of Seville. Prepare ye, therefore, your heart. For the Eucharist is a communion, whereby we have fellowship with Christ, and receive his humanity and divinity, and unite ourselves between us. Saint John Damascus. Let them hear, then, who wish to weaken this word of the body, as if it were not the true body of Christ which is now celebrated in the sacrament by the Church, nor his real blood. They seem desirous to approve or invent something new, as if it were merely a certain virtue of Christ's body or blood, so that the Lord is made to speak falsely, when truth itself says, "This is my body." He did not then say, when he broke and gave the bread, "This is," or "in this mystery is," a certain virtue or figure of my body, but he said plainly, "This is my body," and, therefore, it is what he said, not that which anyone may imagine. No one has as yet openly gainsaid that which the whole world believes and confesses. Saint Paschasius. In churches, the Eucharist is always accessible, which custom the ancient churches have preserved. Lutprand. Wherefore, Christ cannot be accused of forgetfulness. Christ does not enjoin things contrary to his commands. He is the bread that came down from heaven, which is daily brought to the table of the Church, as a heavenly food, which is broken for the forgiveness of sins, which feeds and nourishes unto life everlasting them that eat the same. Saint Peter Damian. Neither need we pretend that to this our age is denied, either that apparition, which was vouchsafed to the fathers of the ancient covenant, or that presence of his body, which was exhibited to the apostles. Since, to them that consider faithfully, neither the one nor the other can be wanting. Surely, it cannot in the least be doubted that, in the sacrament, we have even now present with us the true substance of his body. We have revelations, but in spirit and in power, so that it is proved that naught is wanting in any kind of grace. Saint Bernard. The delightfulness of this sacrament none can adequately express, whereby spiritual sweetness is tasted in its very source, and the remembrance of that most excellent charity which he manifested in his passion is recalled to mind. Wherefore, that the immensity of this love might be the more intimately imprinted in the hearts of the faithful, at the Last Supper, when, after he had celebrated the Passover with his disciples, he was about to pass from this world to the Father, he instituted this sacrament, as an everlasting memorial of his passion, the fulfillment of the ancient figures, the greatest of the miracles wrought by him, and the exceeding comfort of those that were saddened by his absence. Saint Thomas Aquinas. A spiritual and interior person finds in the partaking of the body of Christ Jesus 12 excellent fruits: fortitude, to forsake easily things earthly and perishable; progress, in the things relating to salvation; elevation of the soul above whatever is outside of God; strength to practice good; enlightenment of the understanding more perfectly to know God, and all things which are seen in the mirror of eternity; fervor of love for God; fulfillment of those things which beget happiness; a treasure of wealth; a constant cheer; fullness of spirit; a certain secure firmness; perfect peace; union of the soul with God. Thaler. O precious, magnificent, saving banquet, replete with every delight! By this, sins are cleansed away, virtues increased, the mind is enriched with the abundance of all graces. Saint Antoninus. Therefore, delivering her doctrine concerning this august and divine sacrament which the Catholic Church, instructed by Jesus Christ our Lord himself, and by his apostles, and taught by the Holy Spirit, who always inspires her with every truth, has ever retained and will preserve to the end of the world, she teaches, and openly and simply professes that, in the bountiful sacrament of the Eucharist, after the consecration of the bread and wine, our Lord Jesus Christ, true God and man, is truly, really, and substantially contained under the appearance of those visible elements. She warns, exhorts, prays, and entreats, through the tender mercy of our God, that all and each one of those that bear the name of Christian, do meet and agree, in this sign of unity, this bond of charity, this symbol of concord. Mindful of so great a majesty, and so eminent a love of Jesus Christ our Lord, who, as the price of our salvation, laid down his beloved life, and gave us his flesh to eat, that they do believe and revere these sacred mysteries of his body and blood, with constancy and firmness of faith, with devotedness, and piety and worship of spirit, so that they may be enabled frequently to receive this supersubstantial bread, and that this may truly be to them everlasting life and health of the soul, that, being invigorated by the strength thereof, they may be enabled, from the journey of this weary pilgrimage, to come to the heavenly country, that to eat unveiled the same bread of angels, that now they eat hidden beneath the sacramental veils. Council of Trent. O Lord God! How did the faithful, through all ages, burn and honor you in this sacrament of your love? With what piety did they strive here to exhibit for you the utmost reverence? How they did exert themselves to show due gratefulness to your heart, and to compensate by love for the love of your heart? And, therefore, too, should we be blamed, we, the heirs of the faith once delivered to the saints, we, the children of the saints, were we to grow lukewarm in this devotion of devotions, in this chief point of our religion, while so long a succession of ages calls forth our lively faith, when so great a multitude of the faithful of all times and places throughout the world stimulate us by their example, and since so great a goodness of your heart excites our hearts. Enliven our faith, most loving Jesus, and, when enlivened, increase it unceasingly. Strengthen our hope and confidence. Enkindle and inflame our love. Grant, O Lord, that we may ever be enabled to worship in the spirit of faith, to venerate devotedly this most sacred and most sweet mystery, and to partake worthily.
That for which my heart longed, that which it sought through every excess of love, this it now enjoys contented in the holy sacrament of the Eucharist. See. Now not only the justice of my heavenly Father, but also the love of my heart is satisfied. Here rejoices and exults my heart, that nothing is now wanting to its wished for bliss. Rejoice with me, my child, because here is the joy, the delight, the blessedness of my heart. Here is the new heaven, wrought and adorned by skill divine, where my heart is well pleased and blissful all days. Yet see, child, my heart does not in this enjoy those things wherein the world by its vain struggles seeks for happiness. I does not possess the display of earthly wealth, nor the pleasures of the senses, nor those objects which flattens the passions. All these I willingly do without, frequently even I am wont to be surrounded with what the world shuns and abhors. Yet my heart is completely content and blissful. Why should my heart not be happy here, since in this paradise of supernatural delights it overflows with a torrent of divine joys and supreme sweetness? I am perfectly happy in heart by possessing those things which as the Son I have by inheritance from the Father, and which, as the Savior of the world, I have acquired at the price of my life. But you, my child, where do you seek your felicity? Is it also in the divine union, in supernatural communing, in the sweet consolation of the divine good pleasure? Do you not sometimes lose the joy or even the peace of your heart, because you have not that which gratifies nature? Are you also, according to the divine will, gladly deprived? Look attentively, child, and be persuaded that your heart, like mine, cannot be made happy by the love and enjoyment of things sensible, of objects created, but of those which are supernatural and divine. Here, moreover, is my heart blissful, by reason of the happiness which the faithful draw from this fountain of blessings, where they partake with me. As a good father experiences happiness when he finds himself among his beloved children, so do I in the midst of my people. Here the faithful, as children most dear to my heart, are trained and formed by me, they banquet, they entertain themselves with me, they drink in the generosity and fortitude of my heart, they are incited to emulate my virtues, they learn to glorify and delight in the same things with me. For this is my heart glad indeed, as it deems itself happy whenever it has made others happy. Rejoice with me, my child, seeing that your happiness is not only an object of care, but also of joy to my heart. Oh, if you knew, How great a bliss my heart does, over and above, enjoy here, on account of the tenderness, the devotedness of the love of so many souls, that, in every state and condition of life, are wholly consecrated to me, and live, with every affection of their heart, for me alone. Here, my child, here is Benjamin with me in ecstasy of mind. Here are pure souls enraptured with heavenly delights, wherewith the angels themselves are inebriated. Here those generous souls, although weak by nature, form great and noble designs for me, and, by affection and deed, make compensation for the sacrifices of my love, consecrate themselves wholly to my interests. And should not I be delighted with a love so great, so tender, so chaste? Should I not pour forth my whole heart upon them? Shall I suffer myself to be overcome by tenderness and generosity of love? My delight is to be with the children of men, the height of my delight to enjoy the love of pure souls, and, in return, to make them taste the sweets of my love. Here, therefore, is my heart in various ways, and perfectly replenished with bliss. Yet if there be any who are ungrateful or degenerate, and who are insensible to my love, or act unjustly towards my heart, they only can make themselves wretched, but cannot render me unhappy. For, since I am risen to a life of glory, I die no more, neither am I affected by sorrow. My joy, my beatitude, is perfect and complete, none shall take it away from my heart, none shall lessen the same. As my heart is personally united to the divinity, it is blissful with the beatitude of the very divinity. And therefore, in order that my heart may be perfectly blissful, it needs no external means, for, whether these be present or absent, it will ever be most blessed. No less blissful in the hut with the dying poor, than in the palace of the nobleman or king, as blissful in the tabernacle of the altar, as upon the throne in heaven. For the reason of my beatitude is within, hence it is ever the very same in every place, at all times, under all circumstances. This is the inner recess, where I have placed my abode, where I dwell in light inaccessible, where I enjoy a full and unchangeable beatitude. The angels that throng around me are filled with wonder, and prostrate they worship, and exulting they exclaim, "Let us be glad, and give glory to our God." And much more are they rejoiced at my bliss than at their own, for, wrapped in me, and forgetful of themselves, in their exceeding love for me, they exult with me amid joys unutterable. In like manner, do many faithful souls, although still in the body they experience the miseries of this mortal life, rejoice exceedingly, because I am what I am, and they derive the highest happiness from this, that they know that I am supremely blessed. And you also, my child, if you love me truly, you will surely rejoice for that I am blissful, not only in the enjoyment of the highest glory at the right of God the Father, but also in this sacrament of the love of my heart.
You are my witness, most sweet Jesus, and know that, through love for you, I rejoice at your perfect beatitude in the most delightful sacrament of your heart. Yes, Lord, my heart and my whole soul rejoices in you, because your heart is blessed, and is confirmed in blissfulness forever. Oh, how truly must the highest joy overwhelm me, because, your passion being now over, your glory and bliss are full, and placed beyond every change. It is true that, since I still have to endure the hardships of my banishment, the time has not yet come to rejoice at my own glory and bliss everlasting, but, meanwhile, it is enough for me that you, my God, my Savior and Father, rejoice to the utmost fullness, in glory and supreme beatitude. This is for me a reason to rejoice, and to rejoice with my whole heart, even while I abide and weep in my captivity, and call to mind my everlasting inheritance in heaven, which, as God, you have prepared for me, which, when lost, as Savior, you have repurchased for me, which, as Father, you bequeath to me. And because it is right and just that I love you more than myself, and whatever is my own, so, in like manner, it is right and wholesome that I rejoice more at your beatitude than at my own happiness, either present or future. And in reality, Lord Jesus, I do rejoice more intensely on account of your glory and blessedness than on account of any honor or exaltation of my own, on account of any joy or consolation whatsoever. but I also rejoice, with all my heart, at the very joy where your heart is replenished by the happiness, the devotedness, the love of so many souls, throughout the earth, consecrated to you. Grant, O most kind Jesus, that I, too, may be of the number of those who in return love you, their pure and generous lover, with so great a purity and generosity. I ask not for the singular and marvelous favors granted to them so frequently and so abundantly. You, O my Jesus, yourself do I ask, as a reward of my labors and sorrows, if I have endured any for your sake, and as my sole happiness in all things. Not the riches or the pleasures of this world, not the things which flatter nature, not even merely sensible consolations, can render me happy. My bliss is, O most sweet Jesus, to repose on your heart, to enjoy you. Hard, indeed, is all rest which does not recline on your heart, vain are all things which are not referred to you, meaningless, whatever is not in harmony with the sentiments of your heart, tasteless, whatever is not seasoned with the unction of your love. Grant me only, that, by divine union, I may possess you, love you as purely, as generously as I am able, and I willingly abandon all the rest to others. By this gift alone I shall be most blissful with you.
My heart, child, which lives in the sacrament, is the heart of my church, which is my mystical body. This, my body, is a living one, endowed with a soul. That soul is the principle of the supernatural life, which the body lives. This principle of life proceeds from my divine heart, for out of my heart the church was made, which is evidently to be understood, not of the members, not of the body, but of the soul. Many members, indeed, but one body, which, by the divine principle, my heart animates, and fosters, that my life may be made manifest in the body. The church, therefore, consisting of a body, which is its human element, and a soul, which is the divine element, subsists as a moral individuality in the oneness of person, and in the participation of the human and divine nature. As divine, by its influence, communicates the life-giving sap to the branches when properly disposed, so do I, to the properly disposed members of the church, communicate the divine principle of life. And as the vine and the branches are one, so am I in the church, in a manner, one. Truly, then, am I in the church intimately united, not only by a moral, but also by a substantial union, not by a sensible, but a spiritual union, not by an hypostatic, but nevertheless by a personal union, in this sense, that I am so united to the church, that she constitutes with me one moral personality, receiving from me her principal part, her soul, the divine principle of supernatural life, and having, at the same time, members, each of them personalities, in another respect, which subsist by and for themselves, truly distinct and merely human personalities. Thus united to me, thus animated by a divine principle, the church lives, in some manner, a divine life, a supernatural life, a life of merits worthy of everlasting beatitude. No, more, it is from the same source that man is enabled to begin to be a member of the church, when, in baptism, he is regenerated by the water and the spirit of my heart. As the scripture says, we were all baptized into one body, whether Jews or Gentiles, whether bondmen or free. For this did the water flow from my opened side, the symbol of baptism, which is the laver of regeneration. By the same principle, likewise, are the members of the church intimately united. The faithful are, indeed, gently and happily bound together among themselves by many links, but in the sacrament of the love of my heart, they become, as it were, incorporated with me and endowed with my spirit, and thus they become incomparably more closely, more sweetly, and more perfectly united together. And this is the mystery of love, whereof the Apostle speaks, when he says, although many, we are one body, who partake of one bread, one body and one spirit. What wonder, then, if the faithful should possess but one heart, my heart, of whose fullness all receive the spirit of life. For, as in the natural body the blood, with its life-giving power, starts from the heart, and diffuses itself through all, even the most remote and the least, parts which present no obstruction, so the principle of the supernatural life proceeds from my heart, and is imparted to all, and every one of the members of my mystical body, that present no obstacle. By this divine power not only does the Church live, but at the same time that her members are intimately united, by this she is nourished, endowed with vigor, and preserved in the perpetual bloom of youth. If any member is weak, or even, by the abuse of his free will, has hindered or cast aside my life-giving influence and communication, so as to become supernaturally dead, so long as he cleaves to the body of the Church, he can recover life itself and supernatural health from my heart, if, by the sacrament of penance, he cleanses himself in the bath of the life-restoring and purifying blood of my heart, and thus removes the obstacle or hindrance. But the living members of the Church, as they are animated by my Spirit, as they are constantly nourished by the influence of my heart, as, lastly, they abide in me and I in them, bring forth much fruit, true and permanent fruit, fruit of life everlasting. All false religions and sects, as they neither do nor can receive life from my divine heart, since they are altogether cut off from my mystical body, are soulless beings, destitute of the principle of the supernatural life, and, therefore, they cannot bear genuine and saving fruit. For, as the branch of the vine cannot bear fruit of itself, unless it abide in the vine, so neither can men, unless they abide in me. Do not then wonder, if the sects in false religions, like branches lopped off, wither, decay, and finally perish altogether. If these things, whereby the Church thus lives, flourishes, and brings forth fruit, are marvelous and sweet, still more wonderful and far sweeter are those other favors which I impart to her, and whereby she has a resemblance to myself. For, whatever I have by nature, the Church according to her capacity, has of me by grace. And, since I, who am the Holy One, animate the Church with the divine principle of life, and have her so united to me, that we are, as it were, one, she is necessarily holy, not only outwardly, by her origin, by her end, and the means she employs to attain to eternal bliss, but also inwardly, by her very soul, wherein, properly speaking, holiness resides. By the perpetual union and influence of my heart, I perfect her in holiness, that I may exhibit her as a Church, glorious, without blemish, or wrinkle, or nothing of the kind. I cannot err, therefore neither can the Church. Should she err, I myself should err, but I am the infallible truth, whence also she herself is infallible. The words which the Father gave me, I gave to her, and I unfolded their meaning, that, under the guidance of my Holy Spirit, she might understand and keep them. The Church, which is my body, dies not, because I die no more, but so she remains, until I come, in glory, at the end of the world. I, Jesus yesterday, and today, the same also forever, and, therefore, my heart, which vivifies and preserves the Church, nurses and fills her with vigor, sanctifies her by its holiness, and consolidates her by its truth, endows her also with its own perpetual life, and imparts to her a bright immortality. Learn then, my child, how worthy of your veneration, how worthy of your love is the Church, who is so intimately united to me, and represents my own self so completely, that she may justly say, "He that sees me, sees also Christ." Be glad, child, rejoice with all your heart, because you are a member of this my mystical body, than which there is nothing seen on earth more beauteous, more noble, more marvelous. If you love me, love also my Church, for which I gave myself up, and than which, of all the things that are made, in heaven and in earth, there is nothing dearer to my heart. Above all, in the most holy sacrament of my love, you will be more closely united in me to the Church, and there you will better learn of my heart her spirit. Whoever wishes to know the spirit of the Church, must learn the spirit of my heart, because the spirit of both is one and the same. The Church must be considered in the same spirit with which she is animated, and the manner of acting must be viewed, not in a worldly sense, but in that spiritual sense by which she is moved when acting. Oh! If all knew the sentiments of the Church which far surpass the sentiments of the best of mothers, since hers are the very sentiments of my heart, how fondly would they love the Church! How completely would they approve all her works! Pray, my child, that all may know and love the Church, that they may be worthy members of this body, animated with the Spirit of life, members by whom I may be honored and glorified. Pray, much and frequently, that all may be invigorated with the sentiments of my heart and increase throughout, until they all meet into a perfect body, and be joined in fellowship with the angels and saints, who, in heaven, are confirmed in union with my heart. As for you, my child, have a special care, that you abide in me, not by faith, hope, and charity alone, but also by means of the sacrament, by a perfect union. This is the one, the necessary thing for you, that you be united with me. From this union arise for your life, and vigor, and perfection, and holiness. The more closely you are united with me, and the better disposed you keep yourself, the more copious streams of graces, and supernal blessings, you will draw upon yourself from my heart, at all times, indeed, but, chiefly, in holy communion. Hence you will bear much fruit of holiness, whereby you will show forth the divine power of my heart, and promote its true glory.
O Lord, our God! How wonderful, how lovely is your heart! Who should not be astonished at the depth of the mysteries of its power? Who should not be moved by the boundless tokens of its love? The taking upon yourself of our nature was indeed a great and marvelous work of your love, but oh, how much greater, how much more marvelous was the giving of yourself in the sacrament! In the incarnation you assumed our humanity, but in the communion you bountifully give us your own divinity, and grant us your own humanity. By assuming our nature, you came down to us, and lived a mortal life, but, by communicating yourself to us in the sacrament, you raise us up to yourself, and impart to us a divine life. When you became man, you did redeem and gather us together. By becoming the food of our life, you unite us to yourself, that we may be perfected in you and through you. O Lord! How prodigious, how delightful is the love of your heart for us, for whom you work such mighty things! Would that all might know and love these wonders so stupendous, so deserving of love! Would that I possessed the hearts of all, that I might consecrate them to your love! O Jesus, the life and delight of my soul! How unutterable is the love with which you did love me! For, how great a condescension of your love was it, that, by nature, you did create me in your image! But how incomparably greater was that love whereby, through grace, you did raise me to your likeness! What shall I say, what shall I think of that, whereby you did elevate me to an intimate union with yourself? Who am I, and who are you, that you deal in this manner with me? O love incomprehensible! O most sweet Jesus, lovely above all things lovely! How shall I not die, if I do not love you? How shall I live, if I live not for you? O Lord, the principle, the support, the end of my life! Grant, I beseech you, grant that I may live united with you, that I may live through you, that I may live for you, to the glory and joy of your heart, whereby you effect such marvelous, such delightful things.
My child, I am established head over the whole church, the glorious part triumphs with me in heaven. This part, this church triumphant, to which the rest will one day exultantly ascend, is the society of all the angels and saints, illustrious for victories, crowned with laurels everlasting, holy and immutably devoted to my glory and love, by far the most pleasing and most dear to my heart. What wonder, then, if my heart was carried away with this glorious portion into the land of the living, into the kingdom of ever-enduring bliss? But see! At the same time, by a prodigy of love, it was retained in the sacrament with the church militant. In this manner, therefore, it is present with both, and joining both by itself and in itself, it makes the two one. Both have in me the same victim, the triumphant, indeed, has the lamb standing as if slain, a victim which is not now immolated, but, being immolated formerly, is adored, and the church militant possesses the same lamb of God that takes away the sins of the world, a continued sacrifice, which is offered in every place a clean oblation. Both, likewise, use the same table. The one, in heaven, is filled without mystery with the bread of angels, for which, as they eat thereof, they are ever longing, and where they are at the same time, always satiated. The other, on earth, enjoys the same food, under the veil of mystery, in a manner adapted to her present condition. Lastly, both are refreshed at the same fountain, for the one that reigns above, is inebriated with perpetual delights, from the torrent of divine pleasure, springing up from my heart into everlasting life, the other, that struggles here below, draws, with gladness, from the same gushing spring, the waters of grace, of consolation, and of blessedness. Making, in this manner, both parts one, my heart brings it to pass, in the sacred tabernacle, that there exists between them a continued and never-ceasing communication and fellowship. For, wherever I am in the most holy sacrament, the angels are continually descending from heaven, to minister to me, to adore, to love, to praise me. And astonished at the love that forces me, so marvelously and so gently, to abide with men, they, as in heaven before the throne of my glory, so upon earth before the sacrament of my love, with unceasing voice cry out, Holy, 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 Lord God omnipotent! All the earth is full of thy glory. And when they depart, they mount up into heaven, having golden vials, full of odors, which are the prayers of the saints, of the faithful worshipping me in spirit, with truth and holiness. These they offer up before the throne of the divine majesty, and expose the wants of their companions, who are combating upon earth. At the intercession of the angels and saints, and at my heart's own desire, mercy and grace descend to console and refresh mortals, and fill them with gladness from above. And thus, child, while the inhabitants of heaven fully enjoy everlasting bliss, the faithful here are unceasingly being prepared by the most holy sacrament for the same blessedness, and they that are prepared are constantly entering the heavenly tabernacles. Therefore, in my heart is the church, the one in heaven as well as the one upon earth, united. Itself is the principle, by which the whole becomes one, and the parts have a mutual and continual intercourse. For it pleased me to join together all things, whether in heaven or on earth, so that all, being rooted and strengthened in the same, may abound through my heart. It was necessary that this should be done, my child, for, unless I had liberally bestowed the grace of my heart, that men, fortified, elevated thereby, might attain to the heavenly fellowship, they could never, by the powers of their own nature, have reached that supernatural beatitude. In this manner, then, did you draw near to the city of the living God, the heavenly Jerusalem, to the fellowship of many thousands of angels, and to the church of the fierce-born, who are written in the heavens. Admire, my child, these sublime dispensations, revere these mysteries of love, take advantage, for the advancement of your soul, of so great a goodness of my heart, which grants you, although a weak mortal, to hold intimate communion with the saints and angels, and from the same treasure with them to draw forth blissfulness. See, how the church militant, enraptured with this love of my heart, vies, by her praises and manifestations of gratefulness, to emulate the church triumphant. For, as the church in heaven has no rest, but without end praises me, forever glorifies me, so the church on earth ceases not to honor, to celebrate me. Do not let your sentiments, my child, be different from the sentiments of the church, your mother, but have the same sentiments that she entertains. When you appear before my beloved tabernacle, expand your heart, give yourself up to devotion, give glory to the Lord your God. Unite yourself with the church militant, join yourself also to the church triumphant, thus, associated with the faithful, and with the spirits above, praise your Savior God with the joyful exultation of mouth and heart. Fall prostrate with veneration, adore, entreat, enjoy my presence.
O most loving Jesus! How admirable is the love of your heart, whereby, to cheer and console me on earth, you caused me, in some manner, to enjoy here below the bliss and companionship of heaven. Thus, O love incomprehensible! Thus you did soothe, in a wonderful way, the bitterness of my banishment, did change it into heavenly sweetness. And should I not love you after this? Should I not praise you? Should not your love be ever in my heart, your praise upon my lips? I will love, I will praise you, O Lord, I will love and praise you as much as I can, and I wish that I were able as much as I ought. I invite heaven and earth to join me in loving and praising you. Enravished with love for you, let the angels and saints, all the just and the faithful praise you in the most sweet sacrament. Let the triumphant together with the militant church, cause heaven and earth to resound with hymns of love and praise. No, let all things created, visible and invisible, animate and inanimate, that do your bidding, not cease day nor night to praise and glorify you, because you are worthy of every praise, of every glory, world without end. O you most charming of friends, Jesus, you the bliss of all the angels and saints. Where on earth shall I seek for happiness, if I do not seek for it here? Here I become the companion of the saints, here I dwell in the midst of angels, here I find the very delights of heaven. O ineffable goodness! O infinite sweetness! You who draw to yourself from above the heavenly spirits, draw me also unto you, that here I may rest, here, amid the angels, gaze upon you, adore you, praise you, supplicate you. Whenever I am elsewhere detained, draw my heart and mind, that, in spirit at least, I may be here with you, that, by frequent thought and affection, I may converse with you, may be occupied with you. What can I desire better or sweeter in this world than here to enjoy you? Here is the new earthly paradise, where I long and resolve to live, until I am transported into your heavenly kingdom, and triumph forever with the angels and saints.
My child, none shall enter the kingdom of heaven, the church triumphant, unless he is holy, stainless. For nothing defiled shall enter. Whoever leaves this world, defiled with sin which may be forgiven in the world to come, shall be saved, yet so as by fire. In this fire, my child, is the suffering church, a multitude of souls, that formerly, beneath my standard, fought for my sake against the flesh, the world, and the devil, but in the battle were, in one way or another, wanting in their duty, and, during life, did not repair their shortcomings. They suffer, my child, and the more vehemently, since, as they now understand things more fully, they also long the more ardently to be with me in the triumph of the heavenly kingdom. Relying on this certain hope of bliss, they experience on this very account more violent sufferings, for hope delayed afflicts the soul. And, although the soul is glad to be there cleansed, and would not go uncleansed, she, however, finds no rest, but, impelled by an excessive longing, she cries out, "When shall I come, oh when shall I come and appear before the face of my God?" These souls I cherish, my child, because in life they loved me, and did not unto the end leave my standard. Their names are written in the book of life, and their rewards are safely laid up in my heart. Meanwhile, the grace of my heart informs them, the virtue of my heart relieves them, the boundless love of my heart comforts them. Thus, through my heart, is the church suffering vivified, as well as the church militant, and the triumphant, and in my heart these three are one. Animated by the supernatural life of my heart, the one that is glorified in heaven, the one that is being cleansed in purgatory, the one that combats upon earth, all concur in one and the same end, which is lasting triumph for the unending glory of the divine majesty. And, since all receive life out of my heart, and return the fruit of this life to my heart, all good things become common among them in my heart, the charity whereof, penetrating into heaven, the earth, and purgatory, distributes them to all the members, to the advantage of each and all. But as the souls in purgatory can no longer gain any merit for themselves, and cannot be assisted by men, except through their suffrages, my heart drew out of its love a means to help them in the most bountiful manner. For it willed that the Eucharistic sacrifice should be applicable to them, in view whereof, the Divine Majesty either sets them free, or, certainly, shortens or lessens their sufferings. It is, then, owing to my heart that those souls are in this manner relieved and purified by the virtue of my blood, which is applied to them through the Holy Sacrifice. Thus, my child, purgatory is emptied, heaven filled, and to those sojourning on earth the sweetest consolation is given, in regard to them that have departed this life. Behold, therefore, how beautiful is the whole church, all the parts are perpetually communicating with each other in my heart. The militant part, adorned with the victories already obtained, and marching onward in pursuit of new ones, rejoices with those that rejoice in the triumphant, and weeps with them that weep in the suffering church. Love, compassion, joy, prayers are ever passing to and fro through every part. Rejoice, my child, that thou art not of the number of them that have no hope beyond the tomb, but of those whom, united as they are in my heart, Neither the distance of places, nor the empire of death can separate. Take to yourself the spirit of my heart, as often as you are present at the most holy sacrifice, humbly remember the faithful departed, for while the sacred and adorable victim lies before you, it is especially a wholesome thought, a most religious practice, to pray for the dead, that they may be loosed from sins. In the same spirit also, if you gain any indulgence, which may be beneficial to them, apply the same for their relief and consolation. And when you are united to me in holy communion, then, above all, commend to my heart those whom you hold dear in this world, as well as the rest, for whom it is proper that you should pray. Call to mind, child, with how great a feeling of gratefulness and love, these souls will endeavor to repay you whom, by your prayers and suffrages, you did introduce into heavenly bliss. This devotion, this charity toward the souls suffering in purgatory, is a peculiar characteristic of the disciples of my heart, who, after its example, transcend the bounds of this world, and whomever they find capable of being helped, they comfort by their charity.
O most sweet Jesus! What a heart is yours! How admirable! How bountiful! For, in your heart, I find even those whom I had lost out of this life, and I am once more united with them, whom in this life I cherished. Here I hold with them an intercourse full of a sweetness, here I can solace both them and myself. Making use with thankfulness of this most consoling means, through your very heart, I present to you, for the relief of the souls of the faithfully departed, the fruit of every holy sacrifice of the Mass wherever offered. And, in this union, I offer up whatever good works, through your holy grace, I possess. That you may deign to wash away all the defilements of those souls, and thus make them worthy of the fellowship of the Church triumphant. I also offer to you my prayer, and supplications, especially for my departed parents, brothers, sisters, friends, for all, in fine, who have done good to me, whether in things temporal or spiritual. Those souls also do I specially commend, of whose sufferings I may, in any manner, have been the cause. But particularly do I pray for those departed, who, in the present life, have been devoted disciples of your most sacred heart. Finally, I humbly entreat you for them all, that, released from sufferings, they may enter into everlasting joys, and they be mindful of me. O Jesus, you who console all who are yours, and renew all things. When I am here with you before your sacred tabernacle, the world of sense seems to vanish away, for here the spiritual world is thrown open to me. And oh! How vast! How marvelous! With what mighty and countless wonders does it appear filled! Here I hold communion with the Church triumphant in heaven, and with the Church that is purified in purgatory, here I converse, in freedom and holiness, with the angels and all the inhabitants of heaven, here I deal with my kindred and friends who dwell in the invisible world. And to whom am I indebted for all this, if not to your heart? Here, therefore, here is the place of my choice, the place of peace and repose, the place of joy and consolation. Oh, how good it is for me to be here, most bountiful Jesus, source of every good. Let others go wherever they prefer, let them be entertained by the objects where they delight, I, so often as your will may grant it to me, I will constantly repair. Here will I entertain myself with your own. Here will I treat with you heart to heart, in the plenitude of your sweetness. If the works of your sacred heart, Lord Jesus, in regard to every portion of your Church, are so wonderful, so sublime, of which kind, I pray, are its occupations with respect to your Father, by whom you are loved infinitely, and whom you also love infinitely. These, indeed, are mysteries so great, that, were anyone, in order to unfold them, to speak the language of men and angels, he should still be as a child that knows not how to speak. Yes, Lord, these are secrets which it is not given to man to utter. Do you yourself, therefore, reveal them to us, so much as you know them to be useful for your glory and our good, that we may be enabled to worship and love you worthily in your most holy sacrament.
Listen relevantly, my child, attend religiously, and I will unfold to you the divine secrets. Here, in my innermost retreat, in the light uncreated, I contemplate, with heart enraptured, the divine essence, and am infinitely delighted in its perfections. Hence, my heart is inundated with unutterable joys, and it is now the more abundantly and the more delightfully overflowed with these, the more it was, during its mortal life, filled with bitterness. Amid these splendors, amid these divine ecstasies, the Father is in me and I in the Father, and, without the sound of words, the Father speaks to me and I to Him. Here the Father communicates to me the eternal counsels of His wisdom, the decrees of His supreme omnipotence, the most lovely good pleasure of His goodness. These my heart embraces in return, and finds its pleasure therein. For my heart loves the Father supremely, and with such a love for Him does it burn, that it never grows cool, nor loses anything of its ardor. See, my child, a love with which no other heart can love the Father, since every other heart is only referred and united to Him as the heart of a son, not by nature, as is my heart, but solely by adoption. In this, then, my heart is alone and unrivaled. Therefore, also, the Father is delighted, above the love of all the saints and angels, with the love of my heart, because it is the love of the heart of His only begotten Son. As I am the Son of God the Father, and as all things which the Father has are mine, I enjoy them all, I use them all in the Holy Spirit. Whatever the Father does, these I also do, I create, preserve, perfect all the same things with the Father and the Holy Spirit. But as the Son of Man, I, in some manner, annihilate myself before the presence of the Father, and pour forth, before Him, perpetual adorations. Here I worship His divine wisdom, goodness, power, and other perfections, in such a manner that neither the cherubim, nor seraphim, nor any other created beings can so glorify the same. But, whilst, in this mystical and sublime solitude of the divine sacrament, I am thus alone treating with the Father in the Holy Spirit, my heart is not unfaithful, so as to forget the work of its predilection among the children of men. For them my heart does unceasingly offer to the Father its manifold and stupendous sacrifices. If any there are infirm or drooping in spirit, or dead, here it prays for them with unspeakable groanings. And it pours itself out, with all its affections before the Father, that he who is just, may be justified still, and he that is holy may be still sanctified. Nor do I cease with my heart to offer prayers and supplications for all, whom I am not ashamed to call brethren before the Father, saying, that all may be one, as you, Father, in me, and I in you, so they also may be one in us. I in them and you in me, that they may be made perfect in one, that the world may know that you have sent me, and have loved them, as you also have loved me. I pray not that you would take them out of the world, but that you would keep them from evil. Sanctify them in the truth. Father, I will that where I am, they also whom you have given me, may be with me, that they may see my glory which you have given me. Behold, my child, the occupations in regard to the Father, which, here in the holy tabernacle, my heart uninterruptedly continues. Do endeavor, when here you appear in my presence, to imitate these occupations of my heart. Raise your heart above all sensible objects, and with the Church, your mother, who, as the symbol of her faith, keeps a constant light burning before the most holy sacrament, contemplate, by the light of faith, your God, your Savior, present to you in silence, with deep reverence, and pious affection, meditate on all those things, wherewith my heart is here employed. Here frequently resort, my child, here pour out your heart, here love, here delight in my heart.
Oh how marvelous, oh how divine your occupations, my Jesus, in the sacred tabernacle. These, Lord, these, if they are pondered, if they are understood, teach that which neither books can show, nor talents make known. O divine solitude of Jesus in the sacrament! Here is the fountain of heavenly secrets. This is the school of contemplation, where souls are taught to rise above things sensible, to go to the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Ghost, to gaze upon the wonderful works of God, to pray with mind and heart, to speculate on things mystical and divine. The eye has not seen, the ear has not heard, no sense has perceived, by faith alone it is descried, by pure love it is tasted how great a felicity, how great a sweetness, how great an abundance of all good things lies here concealed. Here, Lord Jesus, is the retreat, wherein, At rest yourself, you put all things to rest, wherein you yourself occupied, occupy us, where, holy yourself, you sanctify us. Here is the spot which the angels surround, wherein pure souls long to make their abode. Here, most sweet Jesus, here will I always seek you. Here, I implore you, let me deserve, in your light, to behold the light where you dwell, to be occupied with you, to be delighted with the wonders which you work with the Father and the Holy Ghost, to be absorbed by the flood of divine fire which bursts forth from your heart, in fine, to be transformed in you by love. Bring me, I beseech you, into the very secrets of your heart, and keep me with you in this divine repose, where all merely human emotion ceases, where everything that moves springs from the Godhead and tends to the Godhead. If I have found favor in your eyes, O Lord, give me admittance. I entreat you, unite me with you by the indissoluble bond of love, fill all my faculties within and without, that I may live of you and for you.
Now, dearly beloved, is the Son of Man glorified, and God is glorified in him. How much, do you think, is the Father glorified? How much is he honored by the Son, who, for the honor and glory of the Father, is not now seen on earth, but hidden in the sacrament? The Father is worthy of all worship, praise, and homage, and, therefore, do I, in this sacred mystery, exhibit the same to him, by the boundless humiliations to which I here subject myself. So much the more is the majesty of God the Father exalted, the more the Son, made man, humbles himself, that he may honor the Father. Measure, if you can, the depth of humility into which I here descended for the glory of God the Father. Into a deep abyss I certainly did go down by my incarnation, into a deeper one I sank during my lifetime, into the very deepest I lowered myself by my death. But here, I have sunk beneath all those depths, here I exceed all those excesses, and continue to do the same. Endeavor as much as you can, struggle as much as you will, you may wonder, you may be astounded, but never shall you be able to grasp or understand neither the depth, nor the breadth of the abyss, into which my heart here lowers itself. The very angels are amazed, when, struck with awe, they gaze upon me, whom they acknowledge and worship as their Lord, humbling myself more deeply than they themselves could possibly do. Powerfully, indeed, are they thereby enkindled and stimulated to glorify the divine majesty, whose infinite grandeur they cannot comprehend, but whom they thus more clearly perceive, by my example, as worthy of infinite honor. If the state itself, my child, wherein I have here placed myself, honors the divine majesty so exceedingly, how much glory do all the things which I perform for him, in this condition, give to him? Judge not by the outward appearance, things divine are not to be estimated in a human sense. All my acts, in this sacrament, since they are the acts of a person of infinite dignity, unseen though they be, and displaying no splendor to strike the senses of men, are of infinite value. Therefore, my child, the least motion of my heart for the glory of my Father glorifies him incomparably more than all things whatever is done by mere creatures. Call to mind the great exploits, the illustrious actions, and immortal deeds, which men have achieved for the world and whereby they have spread their renown over the earth. See, all these, compared with a single act of my heart, what are they except smoke, compared to a blazing fire? Even more, add together the virtues, the sufferings, the heroic actions, whereby all the saints, from Abel even to the last of the just, have rendered themselves truly distinguished. These also, my child, though pleasing and honorable to God, are infinitely below one single sacrifice, whereby my heart, here, honors God. What more? Great, indeed, and glorious are the praises and thanksgivings, which the Spirit above, the inhabitants of heaven, offer to the divine majesty, yet, greater, and more glorious beyond comparison, are those which my heart, by one single immolation of itself upon the altar, presents to him. Therefore rightly does the Holy Church rejoice, for that she has for her bridegroom, the Son of God, who honors for her the divine majesty, as much as he deserves to be honored, and gives him thanks such as are due to him. This she daily acknowledges with grateful feeling, when, through me she draws near to the Father, and says to him, through him, and with him, and in him, is to thee, God Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Ghost, all honor and glory. Formed by this divine institution, and united to me, her acts are supernaturally acceptable to God. Whatever she does, whatever she offers, she performs it in union with me, for the praise and glory of the divine majesty, as well as for her own advantage into life everlasting. Blessed are those souls, my child, that, moved by the spirit of their Holy Mother Church, with her unite themselves to my heart and the sacrament, and thus strive to pay to God the honor and thanksgiving, which they owe to him, but which of themselves, they are unable to render. Remember, child, how much you owe to my Heavenly Father, who so cherished you, that, in such a marvelous and sweet manner, he gave you his only begotten Son, who so loves you, that he imparts to you, in such great abundance, the gifts of the Spirit, the Comforter sent in my own name. How sweet a debt is gratefulness, if you have a noble heart! And what can be so sweet, if you have the heart of a son, as to display a grateful mind toward the best of fathers? If you desire to be thankful to God, like a son to his father, honor him, for he says, "If I am a father, where is my honor?"
O eternal Father, from whom, as from their highest source, I have received all things, what infinitely surpasses all, your only Son himself, with all his merits and ineffable favors, the Holy Spirit likewise, and his graces and multiform gifts, what return shall I make to you, for blessings so great, so numerous? If there must be a certain proportion between gifts and the thankfulness for them, I am in every way powerless to repay the gratitude I owe to you, since there is no comparison between your infinite gifts and my imperfect gratefulness. When I consider that all the divine perfections are infinite, and that these infinite perfections, even if you had never bestowed any favor upon me, are, for their own sake, to be worshipped in a limitless manner, I'm overwhelmed by the weight of my debt, to which, I acknowledge, I am of myself forever unequal. But, Jesus, your only and most beloved Son, who, for your love and mine, abides with me upon earth, makes good what I owe to you, but am unable to repay. Through him, who knows all your blessings bestowed upon me, and who fully comprehends your perfections, I do here, in union with the love of his heart, avow the obedience of my dependence, and render to you a worship ever most acceptable in him, in whom you are always well pleased. With all my heart do I rejoice, for you are infinitely perfect as well as liberal to me, and that, in the heart of Jesus, your well-beloved Son, I possess there, I am able to return you, due honor and gratitude. Therefore, I offer to you, all the virtues of the most sacred heart of Jesus, your Son, and all the acts which he does not cease to perform, for the honor of your majesty, and the salvation of the whole world, in the most blessed sacrament of his love. Whatever I am able to do, is nothing in comparison of what I owe you, and this itself is a part of your praise, that, what you deserve, is above every power of mine. But, look upon the face of Jesus, your Son, who is the image of your goodness and of your every perfection, and for your glory, do you receive all the fullness of the holiest of hearts? Deign, I beg you, Holy Father, to accept the merits, satisfactions, and praises of your only begotten Son, as an atonement for all of the insults with which I, myself, and others, have at times, dishonored you. For which insults I would gladly, if I were able, make amends with my blood and with every other sacrifice. But since, whatever I may do, is of itself sufficient, I unite it all with the infinite merits of the heart of Jesus, your Son, and hence I present it to you. Through the same heart of your beloved Son, through which I pay you a tribute of honor and render you thanks for all the blessings bestowed upon me, and I humbly implore new graces for your glory. Above all, grant me, I entreat you, a great and generous tender love for your Son, the beloved of my soul, the most sweet Jesus, who stays here so lovingly with me. Grant that, animated with the sentiments of his heart, and united with this same heart, I may live by him whom through alone I am able to come to you. For this purpose, I beg you, give me the fullness of the Holy Spirit, who ever animated and guided the heart of Jesus. Let that divine Spirit replenish my whole heart, inflame it with the love for Jesus, and stimulate it always with hunger and thirst for his most delicious sacrament.
My child, thus says the Lord, in every place there is sacrificed and honored to my name a clean oblation, for great is my name among the nations. This, my child, is that victim of salvation, which, once offered on the holy mountain for the redemption of all, is offered daily throughout the world to apply my merits to each one in particular for the forgiveness of sins, which are daily committed. For, knowing that the nature of them that were to believe in me, would be such, that they should all offend in many things, moved by the love of my heart, I instituted a sacrifice, not only of supreme worship and thanksgiving, but also of atonement and impetration, by the offering of which God, being appeased, after granting the grace and gift of repentance, would also pardon crimes and offenses, and liberally bestow his favors. The same sacrifice, that I formerly offered upon the cross, I now offer upon the altar, not in a bloody manner as then, but with the same love of heart. As often as this ever-enduring sacrifice is offered, as often as the remembrance of this victim is celebrated, the work of man's redemption is renewed. Upon this oblation the Almighty Father deigns to look with a propitious and favorable eye, and he holds the same more acceptable than the holy sacrifice, the spotless offering which the high priest Melchizedek presented to him. Hence also the Church, full of confidence, prays to God the Father, that the faithful may be freed from all evils, past, present and future, and that assisted by the help of the divine mercy, they may be free from sin, and secured from all disturbance. For what can the Eternal Father refuse when he beholds me, his only Son, through zeal for his honor and his love for men, immolated upon the altar and lying there the victim of his glory, whole my heart and my very blood cry out and intercede for my brethren? Most assuredly this oblation, so preeminently clean, presented by the ministry of priests, through myself, with the infinite affection of my heart, to the Heavenly Father, is always and ever pleasing to him, and is ever regarded for its dignity. Thus, many others are made priests, because death did not suffer them to remain and because this victim is offered in every place, but since I endure forever, possess an everlasting priesthood. Whence also I can save, forever, those that through me draw near to God. Therefore the earth is, as it were, uninterruptedly crimsoned by the offering of this most sacred victim, and its fragrance, blending with the virtues and merits of my heart, is unceasingly ascending to the Father for an odor of sweetness. If the many sins of men offends the divine majesty, and provoke his justice, this holy sacrifice does incomparably more to honor and appease his justice, since his only begotten Son pleases him infinitely more than all the sinners displease him. What land on earth is not in some manner, dyed with the blood of my heart, or what spot is excluded from its prayers and protection? What region then, in this world, can God smite, without striking a place defended by the heart of his Son? Sinners have sinned, and they were not according to their deserts, cast into the pool of fire everlasting, yes, they are even suffered to live, not in order that they may continue to sin, but that they may save themselves. For I place myself between God my Father and the sinners, for them I offer myself, and make intercession, look, holy, and righteous Father, behold my hands and my side, see how much they have cost your Son. By the love that you love me, spare Father, spare your people. My child, should not the sinner yield to so great a goodness, whereby I keep hell shut lest he should be swallowed up therein, whereby I restrain the demons, lest they carry him off, whereby I stay the arm of the Almighty, lest the bolts of divine justice destroy him? You should indeed wonder, did you see all the secret means which my heart employs to save souls, which, unless I turned away the divine wrath from them, they should soon be deservedly devoured. If now, as of old, sudden and immutable punishment is not inflicted upon the wicked, they should remember that it is owing to the sacrifice of my heart, whereby the whole world is preserved. Child, how my heart loves, everywhere mindful of men, even of the most wretched, everywhere promoting the salvation of souls. With what sentiments, then, is it befitting that you should approach this mystery, where you may obtain remedies so great? Where you may secure graces and favors of every kind, for it is of infinite value. But, although this sacrifice is of infinite value, the fruit is, however, applied to man in a limited manner, according to the liveliness of the faith and devotedness, the disposition of the soul of him that assists, or for whom it is offered up, as the Church, taught by the Holy Spirit, insinuates, when during the sacrifice, she prays God to remember his servants, and all the bystanders, whose faith is acknowledged, and whose devotedness is known by him. Therefore, my child, celebrate or hear Mass with a lively faith, a true devotion, a holy disposition, that you may deserve to obtain the greatest fruit of the sacrifice, and secure all of the graces for which you pray. For the divine clemency grants, without doubt, to them that are rightly disposed, whatever favors they ask during Mass, frequently bestowing liberally blessings for which they did not petition. Remember this, child, that to hear Mass piously is a most wholesome means to keep yourself from dangers, to preserve yourself from an unforeseen death, and to follow the path of righteousness. If you will lay up merits so often as it is permitted, that is, to be present at the sacrifice of the Mass, for by the devout hearing of one Mass, you merit far more than if, through devotion, you macerate yourself for a long time by fasts and austerities, or undertake a distant pilgrimage. Lastly, if you desire to make yourself agreeable to my heart, assist at Mass as frequently and devoutly as possible, for this sacrifice glorifies the Most Holy Trinity, rejoices the angels and saints, enriches the just with grace, helps sinners for their conversion, relieves the souls detained in purgatory, in fine, cheers and comforts the whole Church on earth.
O most sweet Jesus, how great the mercy, how disinterested the love, how resistless the kindness, how astounding the goodness of your heart! Even for them who, as much as in them lies, sadden your heart, you do not cease to immolate yourself, that you may stay the weight of the divine anger, while they betake themselves in safety beneath the protection of your heart. And I will confess it, although so plentifully blessed with the gifts of your heart, I, most ungrateful of men, have grieved your heart. To the great mercy, to the infinite goodness of your heart, it is owing that I am not destroyed, that I still remain unharmed. O heart of Jesus, heart full of sweetness and delight, most loving heart, every way poured out through an excess of love. How can I possess a heart worthy of the name of a human heart, if I do not love you in return? Who, O Lord, can resist your love, when he considers how in the most holy Eucharist, you shelter us in your heart and offer yourself to your Father for us? O my Jesus, what would happen if you cast away the sinner from the protection of your heart? How dreadfully would the thunderbolts of divine justice hurl him into the lowest depths of hell! Far, O Lord, far be it from me, that, by provoking your heart, through ingratitude, through sin, I should expose myself to so great a danger. Grant, O my Saviour, that I may be more eager to please you, who are so solicitous for me, that I may love you more fervently, that, through gratitude and love, I may visit you more frequently, and assist more often or more devoutly at your holy sacrifice. O how little do I love you, if I do not daily come to be present at Mass, here to meditate, to converse with you, to beg much of you. How considerable time of the day do I give to worldly occupations, how much to rest and to recreation, and I cannot spend here with you half an hour for the affair of my everlasting salvation, and for the divine glory, the more as I should hence take your grace and blessing, my affairs themselves, and all the rest, would be made holy and prosperous? Yes, Lord, daily will I be here with you. And, if I am necessarily hindered from being bodily present, even then I will be here in spirit with you.
My child, behold my tabernacle with men. Here I dwell with them. Here I myself console them that come, and I wipe away every tear from their eyes. And as there is no place on earth, where affliction does not sometimes shed tears, my heart multiplies its miracles, that it may everywhere multiply consolations. Hence, you may learn, my child, that the mercy of my heart is greater than man's misery can be. If any remedy, if any comfort is required in misfortune, here it is found in my heart, here it is drawn with gladness. Here I make all things new, things that are heavy I change so that it becomes light, things tasteless I make to be savory, bitterness I turn into sweetness, mourning I change into joy of the heart. This vale of tears I transform into a paradise, earth into heaven before its time. For here is the plentifulness of all good things of heaven, here is the fountain of peace and gladness, here are the angels, here am I myself, here is bliss ever enduring. These are the wonders of love, child, which my heart works for you, that you may not be cast down amid the tribulations of life, but that, attracted by the goodness of my heart, you may come to this overflowing fountain of all consolation. If you have once tasted its sweetness, you will soon forget every affliction of the past, or will even deem it all joy. When, here before the tabernacle, you pour forth your heart, above all, when, after Holy Communion, you speak to me heart to heart, and resign yourself wholly to me, then you will perceive that affliction yields to consolation, fear to confidence, lukewarmness to fervor of heart. If you overlook me and run elsewhere to find someone to relieve and help you in your dejection, you shall often say, I sought someone to comfort me and found none. But to the tabernacle you shall never come in vain, hence you shall never depart without relief. Here, the, always fly, that you may receive a remedy for your troubles, and turn your sufferings into consoling merits. If misfortune, if loss of possessions or even if want fills your heart with groaning and your eyes with tears, so as to render your soul weary of life, here, my child, you shall find what no mortal can give you, here, you shall obtain a soothing of your grief. If you look upon my example, your heart shall be comforted, my promise of permanent possessions, which you shall receive by sharing my inheritance, after having passed a few days here below, will cheer up your spirit. Lastly, the secret grace of my heart will often turn the tears of grief into tears of consolation. If the world hates you, if men slight, oppose, or oppress you, here, child, here in this mystery of love you shall abundantly be comforted, when you possess me, when you press me to your heart, me, your Savior, your faithful friend, your best and dearest Father, you will be content enough to be hidden, to be humbled with me, that you may be more like me and pleasing to my heart, in order to forever exalted by me among my elect. And, if you are afflicted or tormented with pains of the body and anguish of soul, child, here is your solace, which alone can reach the inmost recesses of the ailing heat, and which none can hinder, except yourself, by hearkening to your own thoughts, rather than to my whisperings. You shall also experience that which has been felt by thousands of faithful souls that came to the tabernacle in sorrow, and with an aching heart, and soon, refreshed by the sweetness of the love of my heart, went away with their hearts dilated with bliss. If annoyed by temptations, if worn down by desolateness, hasten here, my child, my heart invites and awaits you, thus tempted and rendered desolate. It will receive you with gladness, it will strengthen you by its own fortitude, it will fill you with the sweetness of its unction. Even if you should commit a fault, arise quickly, and run here. Here you shall easily repair all, here you shall recover peace and joy of heart. Oh, if you knew, my child, with how great a longing to console everyone, my heart watches here at all times, consoling itself whenever it comforts someone in affliction, you would then understand when it is that none, no matter what trouble he may find himself, can come here well disposed to my heart, without receiving consolation. For in the sacred tabernacle, you possess me, the same Savior, that, when I lived a mortal life, comforted all, the very same heart, that whilst placed in a manger, gave peace to the shepherds, and filled the Magi with heavenly delight, that, throughout life was the refuge and solace of all. You know, my child, how all the sick and the weak, the blind and the lame, the deaf and the mute, the wretched and the disconsolate were wont to appeal to my heart, and implore its compassion and help. Was ever one of these disappointed in his hope, by whatever suffering that bound him down? Whatever the time of day or of the night he came to me? Did not everyone, whatever the hour he had recourse to my heart, go away more consoled than he had dared to hope? And my child, all these wonders, all these consolations, my heart here, ceaselessly renew, but in a manner more perfect and more useful, more spiritual and better adapted to everlasting life. There indeed, it healed the diseases of the body, here it cures the ailments, the infirmities and miseries of the soul. There it freed them that were possessed by the devil, or tormented by him, here it does more, since it guards the faithful against the demon. There it cleansed those afflicted with leprosy, here it purifies souls, and makes them clean, whiter than snow. There by a miracle it sated thousands of men with the natural food, here it nourishes all the faithful with the bread of angels. There it restored the dead to life, here, what is better and beyond comparison, it preserves souls from death. And as then my heart, full of compassion, mercy, goodness, was accessible to all, so now it is open to everyone, even the most wretched and afflicted. Do not believe, my child, even should a spirit suggest the thought, that now my heart possesses a different feeling, either in respect to God or with regard to men. Take heed lest you deem my heart, that abides here to comfort you, different from my heart, that lived in its mortal life, so marvelously, so sweetly relieved men, and filled them with every consolation. For every spirit, that severs or divides my heart is not from God. Dilate your own heart, my child, and understand, as much as you are able, what comfort here, as from a perennial fountain, flows down upon you from my heart. Understand then, to what a degree my heart favors you. Therefore, in every necessity, and every difficulty, whether interior or exterior, fly here. Here if you are guilty you shall obtain pardon, if sick, healing, if downhearted, courage and fortitude, if afflicted, relief and help, if in danger, protection and safety, a remedy for all miseries, always a true and sanctifying consolation.
O Jesus, my love, how delightful are the designs of your heart, whereby, to soothe the bitterness of this life, you journey, in some manner, with me in my banishment, changing my very exile into a paradise. Shall I speak, O Lord, or be silent about what I conceive of the exceeding love of your heart for us men? Yet, for the glory of your heart, I will not be silent. Thus, O Jesus, thus you did nowhere deal with the angels themselves, thus you never gave yourself to them to enjoy. O my Jesus, infinite sweetness, how immensely have you loved me! How you give yourself to me! How you wholly become my consolation! When, O most loving God, so great a goodness toward an ungrateful child, not worthy of the name of child! Thus, O ineffable love, you display the greatness of your goodness, sign you do not regard your majesty and my abjectness, but kindly follow the goodness of your heart, moved by my indigence and your charity. O Lord Jesus, Father of mercies, and God of all consolation, with how great a gladness do I come to you, full of courage and confidence in your pure goodness. Many, indeed, and great are my miseries, yet, confidently and cheerfully do I draw near, attracted by the sweetness of your love. For now I know that, you are incapable of pain, you are not without feeling, that, although my sorrows do not cause you any suffering, you are not indifferent to them. Now, I understand, that you are able and willing to feel compassion for my infirmities, and that my great and numerous miseries are the objects of your infinite mercy. If I have languished miserable and disconsolate, I myself was in fault, because I neglected to come to the ever-open source of mercy and comfort. But from now, whenever I shall be afflicted, I will arise and go to this fountain of all blessings, where I shall find more remedies than I need, where I shall have greater consolations than I can contain in my heart.
Come, you sons of men, and give ear. See how I am here with you all days. Here at all times, here, learn of me, how meek and humble of heart I am. Marvelous, indeed, did the humility of my heart and its charity appear during its mortal life, yet, here, in my sacramental life, far more admirable is the abyss of its humility, the excess of its charity. This whole mystery is humility, all charity. Here not only is my divinity, but even my humanity, hidden from the sight of mortals. Here is not charity, not unto death only, not unto the end of the world, but unto every excess of love. What I has seen, what ear has heard, what heart has conceived, to how great a degree the humility of my heart does here descend, to what extent love is exceeding. If you are astonished, my child, if you are enraptured at the excess of love, whereby, during my mortal life, I showed myself meek and humble of heart, what must be your sentiments when you consider attentively, how meek and humble of heart I am now, in my sacramental life? So long as I was seen on earth and dwelled with men, at no time, in no place, did I cease to exhibit to all and every one the true and efficacious humility and meekness of my heart. Recall to mind, my child, With how great a humility and charity of heart I was wont to treat my disciples, the ignorant and unmannerly people, the unhappy and the distressed, the wretched sinners, finally, my enemies themselves. Whatever was there that was able to obstruct or check the fountain of this humble and exhaustless charity? Neither the faults, nor the ignorance, nor the impertinentness, nor the obstinacy, nor the abjectness, nor the perverseness itself of men. Nothing of all this could ever make me show myself, even toward one mortal, other than meek and humble of heart. Witness all of the people so hard to please, witness the heathen, who attracted by the sweetness of my heart, came running toward me, saying we wish to see Jesus, witness the woman of Canaan, and all the disconsolate, witness the Magdalene, and every sin-laden soul that had recourse to me, witness the Pharisees, men that persecuted me to death. All these bear witness to the deeds of my meek and humble heart, during my mortal life. In my sacramental life, child, I do the same thing, I continue such deeds, amid these I show myself meek and humble of heart in a more sweet and marvelous manner. Now consider how men here deport themselves towards me, not only with rudeness and irreverence, but even with contempt, and see how I endure this behavior. Consider how many souls, cherished by me in a special manner, when presented with a small share of my cross, return a most precious pledge of my love, bring and return to me here, instead of praise and love, complaints and repining, and reserve, with how great a goodness of heart, I do not only endure them, but encourage and stimulate them to better sentiments. Then, consider, how many ungrateful souls, laden with my favors, depart, and while they enjoy my benefactions, forget and slight me, their benefactor. How many others, who, after having abused the graces I have already bestowed so often upon them, present themselves without shame before me, and clamor for new favors, and, see, with how great a meekness I bear with them, with what generosity I suffer them, with how gentle, and at the same time, how firm a charity, I excite and help them to faithfulness and fervor. Now consider, how the wicked make use of my very gifts and favors to oppose, to offend me, to wound my very heart, and watch, with what disposition of heart I do not return them evil for evil, but overcome evil with good. Consider, how often the enemies, the persecutors of my heart, come to insult me, and with how divine a charity of my humble heart, I receive them into my presence, and offer them mercy, pardon and peace. So, my child, at every hour, at every moment of the day, and of the night, in season and out of season, the good and the wicked, the grateful and the thankless, friends and enemies, all come and go, and each one behaves towards me according to his disposition. But see, by the light of faith, how I deal with each and every one, how lowly, unwearied, exhaustless a benignity and sweetness of charity. These wonders of the love of my heart, you cannot understand, my child, unless you look at them with a lively faith and meditate upon with a devoted heart. For the depth of humility which my heart does here in the sacrament of love practice, must be gazed upon with the light from above, must be entered into with pious meditation, must be learned by silent prayer. And the sweetness of charity which my heart here displays must be sought in this same manner, must be relished by making use of, must be understood by experience. Look, my child, and see in what manner you have up until now. How have you until now profited by this continued example of my heart? Cheer up, and renew your courage, learn by deed and in truth, what I do not cease to teach here, that I am meek and humble of heart.
How good, O Jesus, how good you are, who in order to teach all generations the more gently the more efficaciously your spirit abides, so humble, so meek, in the most sweet mystery. Here truly and supremely humble and meek of heart. You alone are the teacher of humility and charity, doing and teaching from generation to generation. All things around you do not cease to proclaim that you are meek and humble of heart. The deep and tranquil solitude where you are hidden, proclaims it. The solemn silence, in which the prostrate angels adore you, proclaims it. The tender devotedness of the pious faithful proclaims how meek and humble of heart you are, O Lord. O Jesus! Who can still be proud? Who can still be hard-hearted? Can there be anyone who cannot rejoice to humble himself? Can there be anyone who does not burn with love? Alas! O Lord, what faith, What hope, what love have they, that do not yield to you here? O souls, full of pride and bitterness, in the midst of you stands one whom you do not know, whom you do not heed to. My soul, attend and learn who your beloved is, how sweet and desirable and worthy of love. Enter into the place of that marvelous tabernacle, into the abode of your divine Savior, and contemplate the God of majesty, the maker of heaven and earth, the joy of the saints and of the angels, thus humbled for love of you, thus captive for love of you. Here, learn to humble yourself through love, here learn to cherish in purity your bridegroom who loves with such wonderful purity. Listen to such great and admirable example of his, which speaks within you, speaks to your heart, be attentive to him who teaches you so gently by his own example, and confirms so powerfully by his unceasing miracles. O prodigy of humility, Jesus, Son of the living God! O miracle of love! I love you, I cherish you, with my whole heart, O you my meek and humble beloved, most sweet and most pure bridegroom of my soul! You alone I desire to love, to cherish, farewell to all besides. Your love alone I desire, for the sole love of you I long to live and die amid sacrifices, the practices and proofs of love. For the examples of your heart has taught me these things, the unction of your love has rendered them pleasant to me. O Jesus, of all the most bountiful, preserve this disposition of my heart, and kindly grant that, by approaching you here, in the blessed sacrament, frequently, I may learn better to love you purely, and for love of you, to show myself toward all meek and humble of heart.
As often as you shall eat this bread and drink the chalice, you shall proclaim the death of the Lord, until he come. This I enjoin my child, to remind all men of that excess of the love of my heart, whereby I loved them, in some manner, more than myself, since I suffered death in order that they might have life. I glory in the death, whereby while the love of my heart triumphed, the Eternal Father was appeased and exceedingly honored, whereby men were set free and saved, whereby there rose for me the glory of the resurrection and the ascension, and of my everlasting reign over all things. And therefore I willed that there should be always and everywhere a remembrance of my passion, and that they who reaped the fruits, whether in heaven or on earth, should always thankfully remember so great a condescension. Assuredly, in their heavenly bliss, the elect are always mindful of my passion, knowing that to the passion they owe their salvation and glory, and they forever worship the Lamb of God, slain, having five wounds, more splendid and dazzling than the sun. On earth, the Church, acknowledging that she was brought forth by my heart when it expired upon the holy mountain, and that from that same fountain, all good things flow down upon her, does not cease to commemorate with every feeling of gratitude my death, all days, until I come to take her up with me into glory. For the sacrifice which she offers daily, has me present as the victim, and by the separate consecration of the body and blood, exhibits me as it were dead. Besides, in every soul that partakes of the blessed sacrament, there is made some representation and commemoration of my death. For, as upon the bed of the cross, through the passion, I lost my mortal life, so through communion, I lose my sacramental life in the heart of the faithful. Even more, my child, the state itself wherein I here continue is a certain image of my passion, for in my passion, the splendor of my divinity and the very beauty of my humanity was in some manner veiled, and are not the lowly and gentle species of the sacrament an evident representation of this veiling? The sacrifice of the life of my heart, my death, is in the center of time. Whatever had gone before, sacrifices, ceremonies, and everything else belonging to religion, had reference to it, hence they derived all their power and efficaciousness. In like manner, whatever follows it, oblation, sacraments, and the rest, all have relation to the same and therefore possess their virtue and efficacy. See then, the sacrifice offered up from the beginning of the world in types, upon the cross in truth, continued, substantially, in the Church even to the end of ages. Such, my child, is the unfathomableness of the designs of my heart, such is the extent of my love. Therefore my whole career on this earth, from the beginning even to the end of the world, whether through my promised presence, my mortal life or my sacramental abiding, and whatever I effect by these means, is one whole, one perfect work of infinite goodness, to be completed only when, at the end of time, with the church I shall mount on high, to enjoy an everlasting triumph. What wonder then is it, my child, if the mystery appears to you always new, always equally worthy of veneration, when you receive Holy Communion, when hear or celebrate Holy Mass? For when you receive the Holy Eucharist, you should always been present with the same disposition of heart, with the same affection as if you were at the Last Supper and sat down to receive at that supper, from myself the bread of life. It is in reality the same supper, and the same death, that I foreshadowed in the supper room, as you share in the sacrament. By the action itself, child, when you celebrate Mass or take the body of communion, you proclaim my death, since the manner of either, as well as the offering of the sacrifice, as the consuming of the sacrament, proclaims the same death. But when you are engaged in mysteries so great, which my heart by its death merited for you, you must also, on your part, do that whereby you may be enabled to commemorate it in an appropriate manner. As therefore in my passion, I offered myself to God the Father as a perfect holocaust, so you also should offer yourself to me in Holy Communion as a clean and entire victim. Yes, even while visiting me, it is proper that, with great feeling of piety, you commemorate the sacrifices of my once suffering life, which you will do if you meditate with devotion, if you resign yourself to me in every affliction, if you give yourself wholly to me, in the presence of the sacred tabernacle, where all you perceive around you serves to put you in mind of those sacrifices of my heart. Thus, child, you will better feel the greatness of that charity, whereby, from a life of labor and sorrow, I advanced through many and great sacrifices, to that last and supreme sacrifice, even to death, into this captivity of love where I continue to abide as a victim of love. By affectionately calling this to mind, will you not be excited to gratefulness, to a requital of love, to imitation, so as to show in yourself the effect of my example, not only in your heart but also in your works? Then while in a practical manner, you commemorate my passion more profitably to yourself, you will learn not to be cast down or troubled by humiliations, but rather in a supernatural manner, to glory and rejoice. This active remembrance of my death will be perfect, my child, if as often as you approach the sacred mysteries, you die to self more and more and to creatures, in order that you may live for me, and I after having died for you, live for you. But alas, although there are many who wish to be refreshed by this heavenly food, and to be replenished with the delights of the angels, how few there are willing to actively recall my passion, to imitate it in practice. Therefore, my child, many are always continue the same to be imperfect, although they do not infrequently approach the sacred table. They do not correspond to the end of its divine institution and to the grace granted therein, hence they remain deprived of much fruit. If this were understood by those souls, that are more anxious about the number of their communions, whereby they may show or feel devotion, than about the fruit of them whereby they may be sanctified and raised to greater perfection. You, child, be wise and more faithful, recall my passion, express my death in your conduct, that, whenever you receive Holy Communion, you always obtain its fruits of sanctification.
O most bountiful, most sweet Jesus, you did die for love of me, and here, in the blessed sacrament, live for me. Truly, Lord, truly, he deserves death, who refuses to die to self, that he may live for you. And yet I blush to say it, sometimes I hesitate to sacrifice, not myself, but a trifle, some pride, some aversion or inclination of corrupt nature. Woe is me, whilst in words I make profession of loving and following you, I show in my deeds how little I cherish you, how far I am from a practical remembrance of your passion, from a true imitation of your heart. And can I complain or wonder, that my communions produce so little fruit for me? One communion can make a person, that is well disposed and cooperates with your grace, a saint. And after so many communions, alas! Who and what am I? I myself, O Lord, I myself, I own it, am in fault, for in so many communions I have received grace enough to sanctify 1,000 souls, but I have neglected to cooperate. For, I acted as if grace alone, without my cooperation, ought to sanctify me, and meanwhile I have continued to live for nature, not for grace, for myself and not for you. I acknowledge that in your sight I have become unworthy of life, since, abusing your infinite love, I have neglected to live for you. But spare, Lord Jesus, spare, I beg you, my past negligence, of which for your love I repent exceedingly. From now on, I will be more faithful, cooperating with the grace of the sacrament. I will die to the things of this world, to the ill-ordered inclinations of nature, that I may live for you. Assist me, most kind Jesus, that I may thus prove my love for you indeed, and may ever derive, from Holy Communion, abundant fruit of sanctification.
Being merciful and gracious, he love of my heart has made a remembrance of its wonderful works. This it has chiefly done in the sacrament, where it has gathered together its astounding prodigies, where it encloses even the profound mysteries of God. And because these things were done, not for the angels but for men, it was proper that it should be under visible symbols, that by the sight of things seen, they might be put in mind of the unseen, and their sensitive heart might be worked upon by sensitive proofs of the divine love. Such things, therefore, the love of my heart did, and it saw that all it had done was exceedingly good, and it was delighted with its works. All its works are perfect and full of sweetness, whereby it has poured out, as it were, the riches of its goodness towards men. In this mystery the plenitude of the divine corporally dwells. Hence, my child, this divine sacrament possesses, by concomitance, and always recalls to the minds of the faithful, the sublimest of mysteries, that of the Trinity. For I and the Father are one, and he that sees me, sees the Father also. But where the Father and the Son are acknowledged, the love of the two, which is the Holy Spirit, is certainly not unknown. But to better know this mystery, to love it the more, to adore it more worthily, grace is here given to the faithful, that aided and enlightened, they may believe it more firmly, love it with pure affection, and venerate it with a more perfect worship. Guided by this light from above, and strengthened by this assistance, they proceed from one mystery to another. Behold, the most sweet mystery of the Incarnation is also contained in the Holy Eucharist, and extended in a most marvelous manner. What is the mystery of the Incarnation? The Word, and the soul, and the body come together in one person, and these three are one Jesus, the God-man. Now in the most blessed sacrament, the Word, that is eternal and God, the soul, which was created when it was infused, the body, which by the divine operation was taken without blemish of the Immaculate Virgin, these three abide, but they abide in the unity of person. Moreover, here there is an extension of this mystery, marvelous and overflowing with every delight. For, I, the same who, by the Incarnation dwelled in the bosom of the Virgin, dwell by the communion in the heart of each one of the faithful communicants. Astounding and awe-inspiring is the depth and breadth of this mystery, but it is all the more worthy of love, it should be relished with more delight, devotion and tenderness. Besides all the mysteries, so full of consolation, of my whole life are also contained in this divine sacrament. For although the time, when these began and took place, has passed away, yet, by reason of my personal presence, these continue in their effects and are present. Hence, the Church always views and celebrates them as present, and, in meditating on them and commemorating them, she is always animated with her first sentiments, always burns with her first fervor. Look on the other hand, at heresies and sects which deny my perpetual presence in the Eucharist, how in them all things spiritual languish, how dead their ways as we as themselves, when they attempt to recall my actions by means of festivals. It is not so with my beloved, my Holy Church. When the time returns, she hastens to the cave of my nativity, there prostrate, she gazes upon me, lying in the manger, she adores, rejoices, sheds tears, through tenderness of devotion. Here is the Bethlehem where faithful souls find me more sweetly and more easily than they whom heaven called formerly to the stable, where they enkindle their fervor, nourish their piety, sanctify themselves, where they pour out their hearts and consecrate them to me, where is return, they are inebriated and rendered blissful with the sweetness of my love, where the angels do not promise peace to men of goodwill, but where I myself bestow it upon them with a lavish heart. Here is the sanctity where I am presented to God the Father, and devoted to the salvation of men, where I give myself to the faithful, that they may not only take me into their arms, like Simeon, and caress me as Anna did, but receive me into their very hearts, and enjoy me intimately by a favor granted neither to Simeon nor to the blessed Anna. Here is the exile of Egypt, a banishment, not as formerly, of 7 years, but of all ages, a banishment of men likewise given to idolatry, to worship pleasures, riches, honors as their deities, a banishment where I am unknown, except to a few, and looked upon and slighted by many as a stranger. Here is the temple where I continue to be occupied in what concerns my Father, where in the midst of the listening doctors, I utter my spirit, instruct souls, communicate the hidden things of the spiritual life, where they that love me seek me, and like Mary and Joseph, rejoice in finding me. Here is Nazareth, where I lead a life hidden in God, where, being made subject, I am occupied in ceaseless actions, which do not strike the senses of men, but excite the admiration of angels, where a pattern of the interior life, I live with interior souls in a manner known to them alone. My child, in this sacrament are seen the mysteries of my evangelical life. See here the true field of my labors, the place of the well-doing of my heart. For I am the Savior who seeks that which was lost, to amid my labors, seat myself near the well, where I give, from the fountain of my heart, to every Samaritan, every soul that thirsts, the living water which quenches the thirst for earthly things, and springs up into life everlasting, who, when the labors of the day are over, pass the night in the prayer of God. Here, I am the good shepherd, I go in search of the lost sheep, and, when found, I carry it, and warm it in my bosom, I love my flock, and feed my flock with the same substance, I guard all, watching over them with my heart, by day and by night. Here I am the kind father, who with gladness embraces my prodigal son, when he returns, who having clothed him with his first garment, restore and entertain him with a heavenly banquet, and, who, according to their capacity, share all things with my faithful children. Here in the sacrament, I am the divine physician, since I soothe and alleviate, with the unction of my heart, the sorrows of the suffering, since I cure the souls that are ill, healing every ailment and infirmity, since I take away the deformity caused by the sickness of sin and restore former beauty. Here I am the teacher. For I teach by the whisperings of my heart as well as by my example, blessed are the poor in spirit, blessed the meek, blessed they that mourn for sin, blessed that they hunger and thirst after justice, blessed the merciful, blessed the clean of heart, blessed the peacemakers, blessed they that suffer persecution for justice's sake, blessed they that do the divine will, because they are my brethren and sisters and co-heirs of the kingdom of heaven. Here, I am a friend, who style the faithful that by grace lead a supernatural life, no more my servants, but my friends, a friend such as there is no other, more sincere, more sweet, more faithful than all, in prosperity and in adversity in life and in death, a friend that under no circumstances is wanting, accompanying and consoling even in eternity. Here I am the bridegroom, yes my child, the divine bridegroom of virginal and chaste souls, whom I have chosen and espoused to myself that, always and everywhere they may follow me as my companions, them I here honor and enrich, and render blissful, in a manner which fills the very angels with wonder, and yet is merely a prelude to that which I reserve for them in the kingdom of my glory. Here, in the Eucharist, lastly, are all the mysteries of the rest of my life. For is not here the supper room, where I eat the Passover with my disciples, where I pour out my heart to them, where I leave them my peace? Is not here Gethsemane, Jerusalem, the theater of my sorrows? Remember, my child, the Holy Week, how the faithful come, as to the spectacle of my sufferings, how they weep, as if before their eyes they beheld me in suffering. Here too is the mystery of the resurrection. See how the Church, when celebrating this solemnity of solemnities, returns, as it were, with me to life, and how like other Marys, at the first dawn, pious souls hasten to my glorious sepulchre, and behold me, by faith, in my glory, embrace me, by hope, enjoy me by love. And is this not lawfully so? Is it not right? Is it not sacred? For, here I am truly present with the same qualities with which I rose again, with a heavenly beauty, with a glorious brightness, with an incomprehensible subtlety, with a perfect impassibility, adorned and blissful with immortality. Thus, my child, the Church accompanies me through every mystery, puts on in each of them the feelings of my heart, and celebrates each with similar affections. From the mysteries here celebrated before me, the Church, mindful that I am resigning in the glory of heaven, gazes forward into eternity. She contemplates with rapture, she anticipates in affection, those most joyous mysteries of the life in heaven, those ever-enduring festivals prepared for her, promised to her. O Jesus, she exclaims in her ardor, may that soon be for which I long so exceedingly, that, beholding you with face unveiled, I may be blessed with the sight of your glory. Thus, child, the Church glows, enkindled with the fire of my heart here present, thus has she all things present to herself, thus is she filled with every consolation. Take the sun away out of this world, what will this earth be, except dark, cold and a dreary place? In like manner, if my living and life-giving heart, if my sacramental presence were taken away from the Church, all the mysteries of religion, now so full of splendor, so soul-stirring, so consoling, how different should they then appear? Taught by the example of your Holy Mother, apply yourself, my child, to celebrate the festivals of religion with the same feelings, to recall to mind the mysteries which I display here in the sacrament, in fine, to draw for yourself, from all these sources, the plenitude of all graces. If you are destitute of this fervor, you will do everything without affection, without relish, without much fruit. That which enraptures fervent souls, stirs up the angels themselves, will not affect, will not move you. But you will awaken this fervor and foster it in yourself by prayer, by devout meditation, by pious reading, by mortifying and denying yourself in some things, and, especially, by frequently visiting this divine sacrament, and by religiously partaking of the blessed Eucharist, since here is fire enough to inflame the whole world.
O Lord Jesus, how boundless are the excesses of your heart, how many wonders do you present to me here, how many good things, how sweet, how desirable. What wonder if I am allured, if I am gently and powerfully drawn here? What wonder if here be the place of my heart's delights? Here amid the angels I can find you in every mystery, I can behold you in every condition of your life, as my needs, my profit, or my comfort may require. Yes, here I can now be with you and enjoy your favors. Here, if I lift myself up, I may contemplate you in your glory and view the wonders of your kingdom, and rejoice beforehand what you have prepared for me. How easy, O beloved of my soul, how easy and sweet it is, to meditate here, to occupy the mind and the heart with you here, to enjoy you here. For this I need no skill, no book, no labor. Here, present before you, I need only gaze upon you by faith in every mystery, hearken to you, watch your actions, implore you, love you. Oh, how delightful is this place, how lovely the company, how sweet the employment, how holy the intercourse. Who does not wish to be here with you forever? Here certainly I will be present at your feet, among the heavenly spirits, as often as I can. Oh, that I could spend all of my time here, but your will, which is my sole comfort, requires that I be often absent in person, that I comply with the obligations of my state, that I fulfill the duties of my office, that I provide for the needs of nature, that I even use an innocent relaxation. Yet amid all of these, I will frequently turn in affection to you, I will occupy my heart with you, for whatever is the object of my love, there also tends my heart, whatever my treasure is, there also will be my heart.
Attend, my child, and here in the sacrament, I will show you a still higher way, whereby you may ascend in contemplation even to the very perfection of the Deity. Be prepared that you may enter into the divine secrets, and that with all the saints, you may contemplate the height and breadth and depth of those oceans, where in heaven the angels and blessed, and on earth, pure and interior souls draw, and are inebriated. See what my heart makes note to you here in this most sacred mystery, and, following the divine spirit, from what is here made known, go forward into the plenitude of things. But do all this in such a manner, my child, that you become more and more established in humility, that you always glow with purer love, so that being introduced by my sacred humanity, by my heart itself, you may cling as forming but one and the same spirit, to the Deity, as perfectly as you are able. Look into and ponder the divine wisdom which my heart displays in this adorable sacrament. Here it shows those marvelous inventions, whereby it reconciled those things which appeared contrary, so that, at one and the same time, I should reign amid glorious triumphs in heaven, and abide upon earth the everlasting comforter of men, whereby I might be enabled to give myself not only to the human race, but to every individual as well, whereby through the most simple means, such as those of the sacramental species, I might obtain the most sublime ends. Here, you mount higher and contemplate this infinite wisdom, which reaches all things from eternity to eternity, which beholds all present, the past, the future, things existing and things possible. This, by its eternal counsels, ordained, in a manner so marvelous, all the stupendous works of the creation and restoration, of nature and grace, of sanctification and glory. This divine perfection is like an infinite light, which penetrates all, which completely surveys you and your whole interior, from which you cannot recede, which you are unable to grasp. In this light you do rejoice, my child, here you live cheerfully for your God. Observe the divine goodness, which is made manifest in this most sweet sacrament, and is resplendent with such flames of love. Nowhere on earth does the divine goodness shine forth with so wonderful a profusion, with so great a sweetness, for here it does, as it were, pour out and exalt itself, here it gives all things and itself over and above. Elsewhere are the rays of divine love, here is its focus. Elsewhere, there are some good things, here is the fountain of them all. From this, proceed to the contemplation of this abyss of goodness. Look into its depths, survey eternity itself, you shall find no bounds. From this infinite goodness everything that is good, whether in heaven or on earth, derives its goodness, everything that lives, its life, everything that moves, its vigor, everything that understands, its intelligence, everything that is happy, its bliss. This divine attribute is as it were, a bountiful ocean, which arises as a cloud, the plenitude of all things good into which while the blessed and elect are immersed, they rejoice in supreme delight. My child, plunge yourself also into the same, taste how sweet is the goodness of your God, there rejoice, love and praise. Behold, the almighty power, which is revealed in the venerable mystery of the Eucharist, in which alone it works more and greater wonders than in all the world besides, in which it ceases not to renew these astonishing prodigies. After having relevantly viewed these things, life yourself up to a general contemplation of this stupendous omnipotence, which, without labor, at its mere pleasure, made all things that have existence, which produces countless and unutterable objects of every kind, all things that have existence, which produces countless and unutterable objects of every kind, all things, in short, if it only wills, which again by its simple nod, is able to destroy the whole world, and bring all things to nothing. Contemplate the efficacy of this infinite power, which can overthrow all the attempts of its opposments, and bring it to pass that all things warring against it, not only those which are indifferent, but even such, as are evil, do, unconsciously, and even in spite of themselves, concur to its own holy end. By the omnipotence, not only are creatures preserved in being, but they receive besides power to effect whatever they do, men receive the divine concurrence to use their faculties of body and soul, animals their efficiency, the stars their force of rolling and glittering in space, the earth its vigor to produce fruits, the winds and storms their might and impetuosity, in all things their excellence. This divine perfection, in its manifestation, is like the atmosphere, which, when it is gently stirred, refreshes and invigorates the life of creatures, when it moves with violence, lays prostrate and scatters whatever opposes, but to whatever yields, gives a new impulse, and helps it to go forward. Rejoice, my child, at so great a power of your God, place your trust therein, and, by prayer, have frequently recourse to the same. Consider the divine justice, of which my heart reminds you in this most blessed sacrament. Behold, my sacred humanity, which is here present for you, is a sign of the divine justice, of which my heart reminds in this most blessed sacrament. Behold my sacred humanity, which is here present for you, is a sign of the divine justice, for I assumed it, to make satisfaction to the same. And does not the sacrifice, which my heart offers here daily, through the ministry of the priests, put you in mind of the divine justice? Even more, do I not display an adorable justice in the communion, when I give there to every one according to his works, according to his disposition? Hence contemplate the perfection of this divine justice, whether in heaven, when it hurled, like lightning, the wickedly rebellious spirits, and where it recompenses always with a condign reward all, even the least, good deeds of the angels and saints, or whether on earth, where through my heart, it is allied to the divine mercy, and reaches those only who are unwilling to embrace mercy, where, also, when it is justly incensed, it is mindful of mercy, or whether in hell, where for my sake, it punishes below the full desert of the reprobate, and so adapts punishment to the number of grievousness of sins, that it forces the condemned themselves to confess that the divine justice is good. Consider the consolation of this divine attribute which will one day justify, in the presence of all, them that are now oppressed by unmerited distraction, by reproaches, or by calumnies, and which not only restore reputation, and honor, and glory, and whatever else has been taken away, but it will exalt all things the more, the lower they have been depressed, which will make good, by an ever-enduring reward, all deeds of virtue, even those which men slighted, which, in all, estimates and repays the merits of works, not according to their outward success, as does the world, but according to the inward disposition of him that performs them. This divine perfection is like fire, which according as objects are disposed, by the same action, consumes these, cheers those, hardens some, softens others. Admire this attribute of the Deity, my child, exalt it with a holy fear and cherish it more. Direct your mind to the divine mercy, which my heart displays in the most holy sacrament, in ways as sweet as they are wonderful. Is not this whole mystery a marvel of infinite mercy? Who is there alive that does not endure misery? But what unfortunate one has come here with a proper disposition and not found mercy? Here, the mercy of my heart is boundless and there is no end to its compassion. When you have meditated devoutly on this, proceed to the very consideration of the infinite mercy viable everywhere in heaven, which the divine mercy fills with saints, whom formerly it freed from sin and now crowns with bliss, on earth where it hovers over all the works of God and refreshes them by remedy, and assistance and consolations, finally in hell itself, where on account of the merits of my heart it punishes less than what is due, and is acknowledged by the reprobates themselves. Contemplate the vastness of this divine mercy toward men, which embraces all, excluding none, casts off nobody, which waits for the very sinners so long as they live, and offers them grace sufficient for their conversion and pardon, which, in short, extends itself to all miseries of whatever kind, and finds nothing in this world, however wretched it may be, which it is not willing to relieve and, in a direct or indirect manner, to turn into a means of salvation. See a divine perfection, like an infinite abyss, which no magnitude of miseries cast into it can fill up, which no multiplicity of necessities withdrawn from there can exhaust. Use, my child, but do not abuse so sweet an attribute of your God. Widen your heart, be thankful, fly to this abyss of mercy with faith and hope, with love. Observe the sanctity which shines forth in this Holy of Holies, which by its splendor throws the angels themselves into ecstasy. With deep piety look into this sacrament, the mirror of the divine sanctity. Here everything is perfect purity, here, my body itself as a spirit, here, all breathes holiness. Hence, you may contemplate infinite sanctity, which absolutely perfect in itself, is the cause, the standard, the end of all created holiness, of all purity, of all beautify, which is such that nothing can be added, nothing can be taken from. Gaze upon this divine perfection, captivated by the purest beauty of which, the inhabitants of heaven are overspread with a beatific joy, by the similitude of which, when the souls of mortals are adorned, they become supremely ennobled on account of the majesty of which, the demons tremble even in the lowest hell. From the brightness of this perfection, whatever is beautiful, whatever is lovely, whatever is excellent, borrows its every beauty, its every loveliness, its every excellence. The divine attribute is like the sun in the firmament, which imparts to objects the brightness of color, elegance, cheerfulness, which shining upon things clean and unclean, is always equally pure, always equally beautiful. Rejoice, my child, at so great a beauty and loveliness, so great and varied excellence of the sanctity of your God, affectionately revere this sanctity and imitate it according to your ability. Behold the divine immensity, which this sacrament of my heart represents. For here I am holy in the whole consecrated host, and holy in every particle of the host when divided. And by the multiplication or replication of my presence in all the hosts, all over the earth, do I not display a certain representation of immensity? Finally, in every place where I abide sacramentally, do I not deal with each one as if I abode there for him alone? By conceiving these things with a lively faith, you are assured to be led to the contemplation of the divine immensity, which contains all things, whether existing or whether merely possible, and is contained by none, whereby the Deity is holy in the whole universe, and holy in every part of the universe. Contemplate this universal presence of the Divinity, together with His infinite wisdom, and goodness and power and justice and mercy, and sanctity, and infinite perfection of every kind, and remember that in Him you are, you live, you move. Wherever you may turn yourself, you perceive the Deity present in every object, and so caring for the same, as if it were there for it alone. See the birds of the air, they neither sow nor reap, and yet He that is present everywhere feeds them. Consider the lilies of the field, they do not labor, neither do they spin, and yet, not even Solomon in all his glory was arrayed as one of these. Therefore to this divine providence entrust yourself. Rest in it as in the bosom of a Father supremely perfect, abandon yourself wholly to Him, for He has a care for you. See how the very hairs of your head are numbered, neither does one fall without His will. Do not fear. Neither be troubled, nor uneasy, but live resigned to Him, and be blissful in Him.
Truly full of consolation is all this, O Lord God, but how sublime! Of my own accord, I can neither dare nor essay things so exhausted. If, however, your divine Spirit guide me, reverently and conscious of my own weakness, I will follow you with joy and security, and having entered through your most sacred humanity, into the wonderful works of the Divinity, I will contemplate the things which surpass all understanding. Send therefore, I beg you, your Holy Spirit to lead me so far into this contemplation as you will kindly deem it conducive to my sanctification and your glory. Grant me, I humbly implore you, this divine Spirit with His sevenfold gifts, that He may guide me, both in contemplation and in action. The Spirit of Wisdom, who may so dispose me wholly, that I find all things of the earth distasteful and those of God full of delight, that I rightly judge and feel concerning all, that I seek with affection after whatever serves for my sanctification. The Spirit of Understanding, to remove and disperse darkness of mind, illusions of heart, that, with a calm mind and clean heart, I may view all that infinite goodness has made, things seen and unseen, and that I may always understand what the divine will, infinitely good, requires of me. The Spirit of Counsel, to remind me always of my own weakness, whereby I am unable to do anything for my own salvation, and to induce me efficaciously to have recourse to the help of divine omnipotence by whose aid I can do all things. The Spirit of Fortitude, that He may move me to exert all my strength, to cooperate faithfully with the help of divine grace, that thus I may, by generous efforts, aspire after perfect justice, without caring for the judgments of men, regarding you alone, the just judge. The Spirit of Knowledge, that He may teach me discernment, whereby I may practically distinguish between things natural and supernatural, so that my every prayer and action may always begin from you and be perfected through you, and whereby I may so devote myself to praying and acting, that, for the sweetness of contemplation, I neither neglect the works of corporal and spiritual mercy toward my neighbor, nor for the sake of mercy towards others, overlook mercy towards my own soul. The Spirit of Piety, who, by fostering in me a tender devotion, may stimulate me gently and strongly to holiness, and may cause me to conduct myself as a compassionate parent towards inferiors, as an affectionate brother towards equals, as a dutiful son towards superiors. The Spirit of a loving fear, of a filial, pure love, whereby I may everywhere, supremely revere you, my God, and joyfully fulfill, with a holy affection, your every will,